With roll call, please.
Councilor Arnone.
Here.
Councilor Bosco. Councilor Capella.
Here.
Councilor Davis. Councilor Jennings.
Here.
Councilor Edgar.
Here.
Councilor Falk.
Yes.
Mayor Colton.
Here.
Deputy Mayor Lee. Councilor Ludwig.
Here.
Councilor Susa.
Here.
There's eight members present, three are absent.
All right, budget discussions. First one up, public safety.
Carl, the floor is yours, sir.
All right.
Good job, Carl, thank you.
Any questions?
I hope no one's dropping my house while I'm here.
All right, so good evening and thank you, members of the council, for letting us present the budget for the police department. I think everybody knows everyone, but I want to make sure everybody knows. To my left is Deputy Chief Gary Collins, Captain Jeff Golden, and Captain Fred Hall. So as we go through the budget, we have some explanations. I'm sure you'll have questions, and we welcome questions if you have it. Just to get off this topic real briefly, we had a very trying day at the police department today. I'm sure you heard about the bank robbery in town. The subsequent bank robber ended up in Suffield, got in a shootout, and was killed over in Suffield today. While that was going on, exactly at the same time that was going on, we had a report on Colony Road down in North Thompsonville. People drove up to a house and shot up the house. So we had shells all over the street. A flagman noticed the getaway car going north on Route 5. Nobody was hurt in that incident, but we were investigating that. So just some days, when it rains, it pours. So let me just get right into the budget part here, and we'll start. So what we did is we followed the format that the manager gave us. I think all the department heads are following it. We listed the largest changes in our budget, both things that were increased and decreased. The goal was to come in at zero wherever we could. And I think everybody understands this is just the operations part. We have no input into what the town puts away for insurance, heart hypertension, and those other things. So the biggest increase we had was in dues, fees, and subscription. And you see that's up 17%. So what that really encompasses are we have software and upgrades to our new, we call it an RMS system, a records management system, a brand new CAD system. And historically, we had something called DataForce, and the IT department paid to maintain that. Now they're not. It was shifted over to our side. So even though you see the increase, I don't think there's really an increase overall to the town. It's just where the who's paying the bill. And that increase is, like I said, for the new Captain system. We have the RMS, which is the records management system. And we also have, we launched this year our new ASAP system, which is the automatic scheduling program. And that's the biggest increase we had. The other things, as you go down the list and you see by percentage, you see 11%, but you're only talking $1,200. It's really not a lot of money. Copy and reproduction are obviously the copy machines and things that we use in the department. Vehicle repairs and maintenance, we're proposing 34.5. I think that's what we requested last year. We were cut to 32, and that account was almost depleted, I believe they told me today. So I think 34.5 would be closer. As far as the gasoline goes, we rely 100% on fleet to tell us what we should anticipate for the gas. And my understanding is that they don't really have a good handle on that until January, but that's the amount of money they told us we should budget for that. The other equipment is a $200 change, so there's really not much there. Our food account is down, you can see there, 6%. Last year we had our CLIA accreditation and we had people that traveled to the CLIA conferences. One of the things you'll see in the budget this year is because of staffing, we're going to make some changes to training. So when we send people places for training, we have to pay for their food. We anticipate a decrease in the amount of training we're going to be able to do, and it affects across the board various line items, in this case, our food budget. Postage, $500 difference. Vehicle supplies, $500. Tech supplies and materials was cut to $39.50. That account, I don't know if $39.50 is going to make it, but we'll do what we can and have to adjust it next year. We will. And the same thing with the advertising. So the first part of this, and this is where maybe some questions, or maybe I'll finish, and this is where some discussion might take place. What aren't we going to be able to do this year? So let me just start off by saying I think everybody understands, and my purpose for bringing this up is just to be transparent, and so everybody on the council knows where we sit right now. We have had an authorized strength of 101 officers. The council froze 6 positions last year. That brought us to 95. We have 4 officers that have left, and to date we've hired 2 of those back. We filled 2 of those. So we're currently running 8 people short. One of the advantages the drop plan has been able to do is that it allows the municipality to forecast when people are going to retire. And there's no option on the drop plan. So I can tell you there's at least 3 people in the department that can't, or 4 people in the department that can't be here a year from now because of the drop plan. So we have 8 and 4. We have, and that's what we know for sure. We've had visits from the U.S. Secret Service. We have officers looking, one officer looking to work for them. We have another officer that's about ready to go to the Connecticut State Police Academy. We have another officer looking at Bridgeport. And these people have not given us definite they're leaving, but they may be leaving. And the reason I'm bringing this up is if we go from 8 open positions to 12 or 13, what I think everybody knows is that when you authorize the department and say, listen, we're not comfortable with that, hire some people back. We're limited because we can only hire, we can try to get certifieds, and we've been successful with that. But what you need to understand is when we can't get certifieds, we have to send people to the police academy. Everybody in this room knows how bad the state is. They've cut back their training program. They run 2 classes a year. There's only 30 seats, right, Gary, roughly?
Roughly, yes.
30 seats, and all the municipalities except for Hartford and the big cities are vying for these seats. We do our best. We're lucky if we get 1 or 2 seats, maybe 3 on a great year. So we could do that twice, but understand that the time that we hire an officer to the time that officer is on the road taking assignments is a year. There's a year lag time behind. So if today you said hire 3 people and we could do it and could get into the academy, we would see relief a year from now. So that's just, when you have a lot of openings, just something to consider. It's like a big boat. You can't turn on a dime. We can't just put these people on the road. And what that's going to affect is, and I mentioned this last night, everybody knows it, I don't want to be redundant, but for those of you that weren't there, our narcotics unit was a home run, in my opinion. The officers that we assigned to that did some outstanding work. And when people ask us, what have we been doing about the opiate crisis, I just want to remind everyone, way back in 2014, we did that undercover sting at one of the local bars. We arrested 25 dealers who a lot of them are still in jail. We did the same thing in 2015 with our own personnel. We got another 15, all solid cases. And in 16, we started to look at putting this task force together. It does us no good to get people in Enfield knowing you can't buy drugs here, but if I go across the bridge or into East Windsor, they're readily available. So we partnered with East Windsor, Windsor Locks and Suffield. We were cross-sworn, the council approved it, and we started the North Central Regional Narcotics Task Force. In the 10 months they were in operation, I have just some quick statistics here, that unit made 50 arrests, and all those arrests are for heroin and cocaine. There's no possession of marijuana things in here. A lot of those people are in prison right now. They serve 25 search and seizure warrants. 6 firearms were seized, 12 ounces of crack cocaine, several pounds of marijuana, and over 5,000 bags of raw and packaged heroin and or fentanyl, 6,000 prescription pills. And as a result of these joint investigations, currently there's $1.2 million in cash that we're sitting on right now. So you might be thinking, what are you going to do with the $1.2 million? So that's up for the courts. They're going to have to make a determination that this money was derived legally, and it isn't. It's all drug money. So typically, we go through an asset forfeiture program. We usually go through the state, but we opted not to do that this time because the state is in big trouble. And in the past, the Connecticut chiefs have told us they're going to just take that money from you. So we did it through the feds. So when it finally gets around and it's adjudicated, we got to split it with everyone. We're looking, I think, at, is it 20%, Fred, roughly?
Roughly
20% of $1.2 million will come back to the department in the drug asset forfeiture account. By law, that money has to go there. The town's prohibited from using that to supplement overtime or salary. It has to be used to fight specific drug activity, whether it's cameras or whatever. So the unit was outstanding, and I can't tell you how, I guess disappointed would be an understatement, that we don't have that unit up and running right now, especially when there's no signs of the opiate crisis, whatever you want to call it, subsiding. And I double-checked today, and we checked with the ME's office. What I said last night was on the low side. We've got between 25 and 30 people dead in our town from heroin overdoses in the past 24, 26 months. With reduced staffing, probably the number one complaint we hear from residents is speeders. People are speeding on our street. Typically, we put the radar trailer out there, and then we sign officers to run radar. We're running more and more minimum shifts, and there's not time for them to do the radar, because what has to happen is when people call the police, they dial 911, we need to respond. We need to respond quickly. So that's the priority. So traffic, radar, things like that, is going to be reduced. Mandatory training, or I should say non-mandatory training. There was a time in our department where the only training we did was what we had to do to be certified by the state. And we moved on from that, and we became CALEA accredited. That required more training. And then we went beyond that. In the past couple years, the council has blessed us with money for that. And we've done non-mandatory training in areas like how to deal with mental health patients. We have more than our share of people with mental health issues. They're not criminals, but they need to be handled a certain way. We do a lot of training in that area. We do training in introductory Spanish for our officers. We have a Hispanic population. We want to communicate with them. So we've done some of that. We've done interview and interrogation. We've done a lot of training, we think, that makes us a better department that we're going to have to look at. Not because we don't have the money to do the training. I don't have the money to take the guy or the lady off the road and backfill it. So there's an area that I think you could see a reduction in. And as far as reduction in directed patrols, that's what I was talking about. Every single 911 call is answered, and it's handled and answered quickly. That'll always be the case. But when they're doing that, there's not a lot of downtime to then do the 40, you know, the checking of the buildings, the making sure people aren't running the stop sign. I think those are the main areas that you're going to see reductions in. And Fred, we were talking today about, if you could just talk about, it may seem like there's a conflict there, that I'm saying we can't staff the narcotics unit, but we're going to do a reduction in patrols. Could you speak to that? Just
sure. A way to read this is...
Actually, it's the second part. Let me just do that, then let Fred go. We are going to maintain our state certifications and the CALEA standards, because we want to keep our standards high. And we do want to direct narcotics investigations focusing on heroin and opiates. And there's the dichotomy. You look at where it says direct narcotics, and then on top I'm saying you can't. And Captain Hall can explain that a little better.
So we really have no choice but investigate heroin crimes. There's a nexus between almost every crime we investigate now to heroin. It's safe to say a vast majority of the shoplifting and burglaries and the robberies and so forth have a direct connection to heroin. So unfortunately, most of our, or many of our death scenes. So we see direct narcotics investigations. Another way to read that is patrol-directed narcotics investigations. And another way to read that would be reactive investigations. Whereas the narcotics unit was proactive, working on targeting and finding mid to high-level dealers, the direct narcotics we're talking about here are reactive patrol when they have a chance to do selective enforcement or whatever in the midst of another investigation, finds paraphernalia, substances, indicators of heroin use, they take action. I would note on that we're one of the few departments in the state. We have all our FTOs trained in, by the Office of the Chief Medical State Examiner, Medical Examiners, the investigator on death scene, heroin-related death scene investigations. And so well received that we're putting our entire patrol division through that pretty soon. It's an unfortunate necessity, kind of where we're at right now.
Yeah, and I just went with Captain Hodges to piggyback on what he said. So a good example of being reactionary is last night, we got information from a undisclosed law enforcement agency that a convicted narcotic dealer that's been convicted for selling cocaine many times with a long track record is on probation, was coming into our town from Hartford bringing heroin in. So the officers got the tip, they saw him, they were able to pull him over, and he had a can. It looked like a A&W root beer can, but really it was a place to hide. It unscrewed, and it was solid either heroin or fentanyl in there. We don't allow our officers to field test that anymore because of the lethality of the fentanyl. Just touching it could make officers ill. So we package it up, the dog hit on it. And they told me today that when that's all cut, that's another 500 bags of heroin. In addition to that, we arrested an individual yesterday who had another lengthy record of drug sales, who's on probation for sale of cocaine. Last June, our narcotics unit that we had set up undercover buys, and these buys were tremendous. They were audio, visual, and there's the guy handing the heroin to the cop, and there's the cop paying the money. Solid cases. We did one here. We did one in East Windsor. We got warrants. He took off, couldn't find them. And last night, or two nights ago, he got in a pursuit with the Manchester police, and when they caught him, they found out that we wanted him. So we arrested him last night. So those are good things, but they're reactionary. They're not, like the captain said, proactive. The other thing we're doing because of the staffing is that in the department, we have a minimum shift that's determined by me, how many officers we're going to put out. For the most part, we stay at 7. Now, depending on what's going on in town on a particular weekend, if there's a special event, we could raise that to 30 or whatever's going on. But because of the staffing issues we're having, what we're doing now is on the midnight shift, Captain Hall did a very thorough research into the calls for service we have, what days of the week, what time of the day. And I think we could pretty much guess that the midnight shift is not the most active shift in numbers, especially between the hours of 2 a.m. and 6 a.m. Doesn't mean there's not activity, it's just not as high. So after speaking to the headquarters commander on that shift, we rolled out a trial program to go down to a 6-person minimum instead of 7. That's going to allow our officers to get some time off, because if we keep it at 7, we're not paying overtime to give people time off. And so far, it's a trial thing. We're going to see how that works. But that's another step we've had to take because of staffing concerns. Okay, so that's it for the police part. And then there's just one quick slide. Brian, should I just do communications? This is really, I don't think there's any questions here. This is our dispatchers. $1,000 for other supplies and materials, $2,500 for other equipment. The telephone, you notice there's a decrease. I believe the IT department is picking up under their side of the budget, part of the telephone, equipment and repair, and that's it. The only thing I would tell you about communications is we're currently two dispatchers short, and we're soon going to have a third. And that's really, really significant in the dispatch ranks because that's going to incur overtime. So we've already been in touch with the human resource director to get a test going to get some people on board with that. And I think there's no change in the furniture, dues and fees, things like that. So we are going to continue to maintain what we need to do. We're going to be responsive to whatever the community and the council directs us to do. But we need to be honest with you and not paint the picture that we can do everything we've done before with 15 less people. And by the way, I haven't even mentioned, and this is just temporary, but temporary has been a few months now. We have 4 or 5 officers that are on
injury leave or long-term injury leave,
which is defined by more than a month. Some of these people have been out. So if those are people not available to us right now. And although I'm not in charge of this, it's just emergency management. There's really no change in that. That's Steve Hall. And there's really nothing to talk about with that. So I think that's the end of it, unless there's any questions.
Questions for the chief? Ed?
Two questions. One, the copying and reproduction, a lot of that might be due to, I know you're bombed with pistol permits. Does that have anything to do with that?
Actually, no. Actually, what it is, Councilman Denny, is that the IT department has recommended that the department, we have like, I think, 4 copy machines that we lease. So the cost of the lease versus the amount of paper we use, there was an increase there, and that's what that is.
Second question is, with your understaffing, are we going to have foot patrols in Thompsonville?
The answer to that is yes, because the council appropriated, I don't know how much you gave us last year, but we were very judicious in how we used it. When we saw that September, October rolled around, the foot traffic wasn't as high, we pulled them because we knew we'd need the money the next year. Captain Hall is actively working on rolling that out within the next week or so. And I believe when I checked, we had $33,000 of that account. So I don't know, Fred, how far will that get us this year?
Well, if today wasn't such a busy day, we would have had a meeting to discuss this. I guess we'll discuss it here. It all depends on how you want to roll this out. If we roll it out the way we had historically rolled it out, which would be to start in a couple weeks with one officer working in for 4 hours in the afternoon and 4 hours in the evening, and then that amping up as we got closer to the end of the school year, and with an increase in hours for both officers, we're looking at the beginning of August before we run out of money. So now, if you don't front load it, and by front loaded, I mean we get patrols out there early, I don't know what effect that'll have on sending a message or deterring what could be happening in the area. That will stretch out, that'll stretch out the funds that we have.
So without any change, August 1st, the money will be gone.
Thank you. Okay. Red, Joey, Tom, Gina.
I think you answered part of it. Under dues, fees, and descriptions, it's $105,845.
Yeah.
Okay, and then in 17, it was $79,697. Right. The difference is there. Is from IT
30.
Thank you.
So what that is, Councilman Edgar, and I got to be very honest with you, this is not my area of expertise. This is when you get into the technical, the computer. I always go crazy when we do our budget because you buy this computer, and then to use it, you have, what do they call that when you get to your user? User fees. I don't understand it. I own it. But if I don't pay the user fees, I can't get the upgrades. So we have no control over that, and then we don't have any control over the maintenance agreements. So, it's this one right here, Gary, right?
Yep.
Okay, so what it, so what this is, they told me today, this is something you don't see, but we need to run the computers, and this is what it is. It's utilized to pay user fees and a maintenance agreement for the brand new ASAP schedule and the records management system. Fiscal year 17-18 will be the first year both of these fees are due, because the first year we got it, it was free. Prior to this, the IT department budgeted money for the data, what do they call it? Data force system, which was antiquated. The records management user fees are $6,000. The maintenance agreement is $9,400. The ASAP user fees are $2,200, and the maintenance agreement is $9,100. It totals $26,700, plus $3,500 for Connecticut Chief at CGIS. So what we've entered into is what all the Hartford County departments are going to, is that we're going to share our record management system with other departments. So if a crime happens in East Hartford, we could do that. And how they explained it to me, that, and Paul Russell's on board with this, they're housing all this stuff, this computer things, up in Hartford. Because if we were to house it here, we needed to buy, what did we need to buy?
Servers and storage.
Servers and Terragons, and it's cheaper. So that's what that's for. And like I said, it looks like an addition to our budget, but if you go look at the IT budget, there's a correlation reduction that they're not paying, that now they shifted over here.
Right,
can you guys explain that?
No. The reason I asked the question is back in 2015, it says 52,710. Now we come up to 18, it's 105,845, which is quite a big difference in 3 years. Okay, and I'm curious to why, and I think you've explained it.
One of the reasons, Red, though, is that in 2015 we didn't have these new systems on board,
yeah.
So there was nothing due. These are brand new systems we've had going on year two. We got to pass the first year. The cost to run these new systems, they're showing me here, is almost $30,000. That's that part. The extra 20 to make the 50, I don't know if that's annual increases in that or what it is, but we didn't have these systems in place. And believe it or not, at some point these new systems are going to be more cost effective for us, because officers, for example, now we're going away, believe it or not, from all paper. All case reports are going to be done online. The sergeant reviews it online, and this is a program that we're working with the judicial department, that the cases will be sent electronically. So there's a reduction at some point in the future in copying, having someone staple, and all that kind of thing. But it's still, to realize those savings, I guess we're not quite there yet.
Not there yet.
Okay. What are the miscellaneous expenditures of $4,500?
There's money that you give us that we use to conduct criminal drug investigations. Is that clear?
Yeah, you answered it, okay. Now I go back to the other page, and I go to personnel services, and I see stipends of $51,540. But I go down a little further and I see stipends other for another $16,545.
Yep. So what that is, Red, is there's three stipends that we have that they're probably not labeled every year the way we need it to be. So what it is one of the stipends is for the officer's educational incentive. If you have certain degrees, once a year you're paid, I think it's $500 for an associate, $750 for a bachelor's, $1,000 for a master's. That's one of those stipends. The second one is the EMT stipend. It doesn't say that, but it's $300 per officer who's an EMT, paid once a year in December. And the third stipend is the extra money we allocate for our dog handlers. We reached an agreement because they're not, they work more than 8 hours with the dog. So when they take the dog home and they bathe it, take care of it, they get a stipend for that. So there's three separate stipends there, and that's what they are.
Now, you go down a little further and you say heart and hypertension, and it's $200,000. Yeah. I thought that was insured.
Heart and hypertension has nothing to do with the operations that we do. Those numbers are plugged in by the town. I don't know where those, how they calculate those numbers.
Those numbers, that is something that the, it is actually mostly paid out for. We have, I think, four officers that we pay monthly, for former officers, I guess, we pay monthly, and one that we pay weekly. And that money goes into that account there. In addition, we pay extra for prescription drugs for some more recent officers that I'm not completely familiar with, you know, the exact history on it, but that's where that money comes from, or that's where that money is paid to. Okay, we have, so like I said, we have the monthly payout that we do. We issue 1099 R's, that's like a retirement pension type plan that we have to pay. We have to report it to the IRS every year.
Okay, well, I'm just curious.
Yeah.
Go a little further. I think you pretty much answered professional development of 61,315. I think you've pretty much answered that. That's your schooling and your, mm-hmm. That will include your academies if you get them in there.
Right, which up until a few years ago, we didn't have to pay for that. And because the state's in dire stakes, we now have to pay for each recruit. What is it, Gary, do you know?
$2,500.
You have to pay $2,500 for an officer to go to the academy. That was not even on the table a few years ago. That's another cost they threw in. They also threw in, when we send an officer to the academy for a one-day training thing, that's now 100 and...
It's gone up. Yeah. Gone.
And I'll be honest with you, attending the chief's meetings, they've told us that because of the state of the economic impact on the state on the academy, they're asking recruits to bring their own notebooks, their own targets, their own paper, their own everything. They just keep adding these costs and passing them on down to us.
I can understand that one. If I go down to travel, it says 15,000. That's back and forth to the schools as much as mostly?
That could be mostly for that, but like I said, in past years, we've sent people, for example, Officer Nasirios. He's trained, now that marijuana is going to be legal in Massachusetts, poses a huge issue for law enforcement. We don't have a test like a breathalyzer for marijuana, but there is something the federal government provides, and Jeff, are you familiar with it?
Drug recognition?
Yeah, just expert. Explain that quickly.
DRE had started out pretty much with Colorado. Officers needed to be trained to a level of recognizing different types of drugs. And it starts in the state of Connecticut, so they have like a two-week training here that's local to get the basic, and then they fall out in Arizona, another 2 weeks out there to become these drug recognition experts. We have one in Enfield. I believe there's one in Manchester.
So where that would be so important is now that marijuana seems to be becoming legal, if people are under the influence of marijuana and they're involved in a fatal accident, we want to make sure that we have somebody as a recognized, and we would call this person in. So it's those types of schools, Red.
I'm just trying to understand your budget. Yeah. We came down to other supplies and materials, $144,155. And way back in 15, it was only $83,000 something.
So Deputy Chief Collins could tell you what that is.
Some of the increase, I'll give you one item, Mr. Edgar, right off the bat. One of our CREST team members, our SWAT people, have been selected as a sniper. The sniper rifle is about $7,000, so that's part of the increase, $7,000 for that rifle in order to be a part of that team. Some of it's an increase in ammo. We try to keep a good supply of ammo. We do a lot of training.
We have to buy the more expensive ammo because
right.
it's, what do they say?
It's ballistic clean.
It doesn't have lead,
right.
so it's environmental friendly, but they charge extra.
Some of it's
for that. Right.
So some of it's an increase in ammo prices over the years. Some of it's availability. We like to keep a good stock of it, so we try to get ahead of the curve kind of thing. We also take our detective supplies out of that and our photography supplies. So it's one of the bigger accounts. Yes.
When you come down to other equipment for another $43,863, what's all this other equipment?
That's AED batteries, Mr. Edgar. So the AEDs are older units now. As they age, they're going to require an updated battery. Now it's the cardiac units that we use. As the units age, the battery ages with them, so we have to purchase batteries. That's one of the items in here.
But also we have in there when our radar units fail, we send them out for replacement. We don't buy them new all the time. They're pretty expensive. That's included in there. The laptop and the cruisers, the radio batteries, spares, all those things.
Taser cartridges, we do
taser,
a lot of taser training.
We do taser training. So that's all that. That's all under that category.
All right. To give you one last question: does the contract with the police union dictate the minimum shifts?
No.
No.
That's my take on it. They may have a different take.
Well,
what it says is that
I haven't read the contract.
No, I understand,
I don't know.
But sometimes there's a debate over that. Minimum staffing is at the prerogative of management, and we don't change it every day. It's pretty much seven persons. Depending on need and what's going on, weather emergencies, big events in town, those types of things would dictate that we need more personnel. The day after Thanksgiving, we call it Black Friday, we raise the minimums, and we do that all the time. So minimum staffing is determined by us. But we're very cautious of the fact that we never want to compromise officer safety. We never want to compromise response times. So this change that we're making by going to a six person from seven, if I didn't say this, I should have. We've also instituted a swing shift between 6 p.m. and 2 a.m. of two officers and a supervisor. So we actually have more people on the road from 6 p.m. to 2 a.m., which is a higher level of activity. And typically, it's not to say at 3 a.m., bad things don't happen, but usually from 2 to 6, we're comfortable going down to 6. And we also told our lieutenant, if it's really busy, you keep what you need to do.
Are detectives part of minimum?
No. Detectives are not part of the shift minimum, nor are the traffic officers.
You don't require them to be there on weekends?
No. But what we do require is we always have one available on call, and in the event we need to call them, they receive a stipend for that, but in return, they can't be in New York, and I'll see you in 6 hours. They have to respond within an hour, ready to handle it. And we use them more than ever now because of the heroin overdose. Even though they're kind of straightforward, we always have a detective go out to that. So we have access to them. We also have our traffic people for fatalities. We're one of the few departments that have the entire traffic department are trained to the level of a reconstructionist. And of course, as being part of Metro traffic, we get assistance from other towns. So.
Okay. Now, I'm curious to hear from you. When we talked to IT, I may have misheard him, but I'm not sure. Every one of your personnel has a cell phone?
No, not every single person. Do we know exactly how many? I know all the
administrators. There's one in each supervisor car. They need it in the field, but not every personnel. Traffic supervisor, detectives have it, but not patrol would not have it.
Patrol officers don't have it.
No.
So it's usually the
specialty
units. the DB lieutenant, all the administrators.
Detectives have it as well.
And detectives.
Done.
Thank you, Red. Joey, you're next.
Okay, now, with the injuries and the short staffing and stuff, what has that done to your overtime budget?
Gary?
We're doing okay right now because the captains do a great job of bumping people, so we do a lot of movement. So we're probably about on par, we might be a little bit over. But remember, council gave us, instead of a certain amount and then coming back at the end of the year, council elected, the mayor had spoken about it, and it happened that you gave us what you believe, you know, would get us through. So we're pretty much on par.
We're not going to make it till the end of the year, but at this point, barring unforeseen events, I don't see us coming back $100,000 in the hole. The things we can't predict is, like today, I have officers on overtime right now over in Suffield, helping them with what's going on over there. But we're very good, Joey, at documenting the overtime, and I give my credit to both of my captains. It's not a popular job to tell someone you're getting bumped to another shift. The union probably would say it might be better if you just paid the overtime. But we couldn't do that. We couldn't do that. We couldn't afford to do that. So that's why we do the bumps. And that reduces it. And all the lieutenants and the sergeants, and I give credit to all the officers, they're aware of that. So when you get overtime, it's all documented what it's for. It's not just do overtime. So that's why I think we're where we're at. Is there any other reason, Fred, you can think?
Well, I guess my question was, is you guys are what, 8 people out on injuries? You
got, we have about 5 out.
6 injuries. Openings.
8
openings. Is there anything you could do? You know, is there what do you have coming in the pipeline for new people, or is there, do you have anyone in the pipeline with that certified that if we got you something, we could get someone on there, which would probably help on the overtime and help you guys?
About a month ago, and I'll let the deputy, because he talked to him.
We have an officer, a certified officer from Connecticut, which is kind of like the holy grail. This officer actually worked for us, thought the grass was greener. It wasn't. He wants to come back. If he left under good circumstances, we'd like to take him back. We could probably get him on board and on his own, start to finish, 3 months maybe, then he'd be good to go. We have another officer that is almost ready to go, entry level. All we need to do is send him to a medical. He's a young kid, he's not going to have any problems. Get an academy seat, and he would be in the process. So.
But he's in the process.
But he's done. All we need to do is send him to medical. So get that done, get an academy seat, which...
Well, that's sending him
which
to
is
medical.
A year.
Right.
He's going to be
a year before he goes. So what's stopping us from hiring the person that certified us?
I would. We do that first.
But what I'm saying is, are we stopping you getting...
Part of the reasons that the 2 positions of the 4 are being held is because I didn't want to bring on individuals who we had the potential to lay off within 6 months of employment. So there are 2 positions I am holding open until you decide on what it is you want to do for staffing with respect to this budget. And as soon as council makes that decision, assuming that you...
I guess what we got is we have to decide that if we want... You don't have this position opened up in this new budget, or you do?
They are. All of the positions are currently funded, but if you decide to cut additional services so that you don't have to raise the millage rate, or you decide to cut additional services to make a millage rate increase go further, Chief Ferrazza operates one of the largest departments.
Right.
It is most likely we will make reductions there. It is likely because personnel are his largest expense, we will make reductions in personnel. So why would we incur the expense to hire bodies today and get them prepped for the academy, knowing we have the potential to lay them off? So 2 of the 4 slots that are still in the budget. But
okay, so these are in the budget. It's just that we have to make sure we're going to keep them next year. And then we could fill them if we decide.
That is correct. And Chief and I just talked, I think it was last week, and he made it known at that time that there was a position in the CALEA, or not CALEA, that was in the DROP program, excuse me, who would be leaving in November. So there are no exceptions about that position. I was unaware of that. So I'm waiting on a communication from Chief which he had promised to send me next week, letting me know that this individual was indeed in the drop program and would be required to leave, and then I will authorize one of those two positions that are funded but open to be filled, so we can at least get the jump on that.
Okay.
So should you cut, there is still, we know in November, there will be
right.
the availability to just not backfill.
Right, so or we could partially fund that. Can we
Correct.
Partially fund that so we could get going? So if we did cut, we could hire someone if we have a chance to get somebody?
Correct, as soon as I can get validation from the chief so I can document that to HR, then we can at least start on that.
And I'll send that to you, Brian, in the morning, but like I said, HR has the drop plan, because in order to sign the drop plan, it's processed through the HR office. But so we do know, the manager's right, we do know in November, one of our officers, we can tell you the day, we can tell you the maximum a person can stay. I will tell you, of all the people in the drop plan so far, nobody has stayed the full 5 years.
Tom?
On the narcotics task force, and you know, waiting for these other towns to come back online, which is, and what I've heard from their departments too, they're also, you know, talking layoffs in some of these smaller towns. So would it be wise for us to go back to a statewide narcotics task force, maybe look to get our men back on the
So,
I forget which one,
yeah.
It was
so,
Manchester.
So Enfield has a history that goes back probably 40 years. We were one of the first departments to join statewide narcotics task force. And over the years, Captain Hall was one of the people assigned there. They're a great unit and they're a great resource. The problem is the name is statewide. They're going to be doing a lot of work, not in Enfield. They're going to be in Bridgeport. They're going to be all over the state. Our officer will gain experience. Yeah, they will come here now and then, but we're not getting a priority with them. The reason we went with the regional task force is I know for sure we were working here, East Windsor, Suffolk, Windsor Locks. To send somebody to the state, I don't see how that would really give us what we were looking for here.
It was like the one Manchester's in too, was the north.
They have a regional task
force. Eastern.
Yeah. They've had that up and running for a while.
Right, because
if you remember, we actually, when we started that, we sent someone to train
yes,
there.
I do remember that.
And what we found out was that although there was people from Enfield over in east of the river, for the most part, it wasn't geographically what we were looking for here. And that's why, but that unit's been running for many, many years. Very great unit, too.
But you know, in the meantime, where we still have that those officers that are trained to work in a task force instead of, it's, I wouldn't say better than nothing, but we do know that the drugs are coming, you know, Mexico, Hartford, Willington, maybe, and you know, and up Springfield, Boston, and,
yeah.
And we're sure. In the line, you know.
I'm not sure, Mr. So. I don't know if you are, Fred, does the task force, and the Eastern task force, even want us in that unit anymore because of the geographic.
The biggest challenge was geographically.
Yeah.
So, we parted ways in good graces. It just wasn't terribly effective. Spent a lot more time traveling back and forth than we actually did doing investigations, mm-hmm. which was the plus to the regional task force that we had. It was essentially a sister unit to the Eastern unit. Although I think we can get back with them, I don't think they'd have a problem taking us back. The effectiveness of that relationship would be very limited at best.
Is there a Central Connecticut one too? The state police run? I'm not familiar with all of this.
The statewide. There's the
right.
Eastern District. There's task force in the southern part of the state.
Right.
But typically towns, they go by region, geographic.
Right. Right.
It makes more sense.
Where the effect you would have.
And
the
there was nothing up here. That's why we created this.
Right.
And
right.
Unfortunately. Don't have it today.
Okay, thank you.
Gina?
Thanks. So I thought I was on board, and then I was just confused by the conversation that Joey and Brian just had. You're authorized for 101, but you said you have 95, four left, but you filled two, so you're at 93. Did we put a hold on any of those between the 101 and 93? So the eight that aren't filled, did we
yes.
in last year put a hold on some of those?
So you
but
did
not all eight.
So council did six.
Yes.
And I have elected to hold
two.
Two. Correct.
So are only 93 funded in this budget?
No, 101 minus 6 is what is funded.
Okay, so 95 is. So just the two that you haven't said go ahead and do, just in case.
Correct.
Okay, I'm good with that. So I guess my other question is, Chief, you were talking about the fund, like the asset forfeiture fund that you were saying, that you have that money in now. And now eventually, hopefully, we will get about 20% of that back. Do we have money in that account now, minus that 1.5?
We do. It's not a once and done. It rotates every year. The deputy audits that.
I think it's around 30, but it fluctuates.
30,000 there?
Somewhere in that area.
I can tell you, Councilor, we've never seen six figures in that account, like we're going to hopefully see now.
Okay, so if you have 30 in there now, what are you going to use that for?
So by law, you're limited to what you can use it for.
Right.
It has to be directly related to narcotics enforcement. It could be training. We sent our officers to Florida for their undercover operation. So it could be for narcotics training.
Mm-hmm.
It could be for surveillance equipment that they need in the cars. It could be for audio equipment.
Connected to drug interdiction.
Canine.
So let me ask you this. Can some of that be used to do more of the, I guess, we don't have a narcotic unit right anymore for the regional, but can some of that money be used for
salaries?
Sure.
No.
No?
You can't use it to supplant. I think that's the term they use, what the town is supposed to do.
Okay.
You can't use it to do salaries.
Okay. All right. So you don't have anything specific for earmarked right now?
No, but like I said, as the year unfolds, if the guys come to us and say, you know, our microphones, our surveillance equipment is faulty, you know, we buy it out of that account. As long as we can show that it's being used for narcotic prevention or enforcement.
All
right. Mike?
So sorry to keep asking about the narcotics. Is there interest at the federal level now? So with Springfield, for example, if you had a cross-state lines group that I think, is there federal money now that you could look into for the unit that, you know, if you can't get it through the other smaller towns?
You mean enter into a task force with Massachusetts? No, that would never happen.
It would never happen,
no.
Okay.
No.
All right. Even if it's the feds get involved and start saying...
The feds go everywhere,
yeah.
But Connecticut police officers wouldn't be, that just wouldn't fly in Commonwealth.
Okay.
They wouldn't let us do that.
Okay, just curious. So along the same lines, do you guys work or do you advise insurance, some of the insurance companies in the state, or even the pharmacies that are over-prescribing the opioids? So do you guys get, I know there's programs starting to be developed to start, lack of a better word, tracking or limiting the prescription of those drugs. Do you guys have influence into that or part of any programs? Like, for example, a lot of insurance companies who have programs that track or monitor the over-prescribing of these drugs.
So great question. Two things have happened recently. The first being that doctors are no longer allowed to prescribe at will the gross amounts of drugs they prescribe. Now they're limited to the first 3 days and anybody can get a prescription. I'm sorry, can you hear me? There is an online prescription tracking forum now, which in theory is a great idea. In practice, it's not where it should be yet. Hopefully someday it will be there. And what that's meant to combat is, if I get a prescription from you, and I get a prescription from you, and I get a prescription from you, I'm feeding a habit, those doctors or pharmacists wouldn't necessarily know who was prescribing and to whom they were prescribing. So all that stuff is in the works. It's starting to get some traction. It's not where it should be yet, but it's certainly better than where we were about a year ago. Do the police have a direct influence on that? To the extent that we would talk to the Enfield Together Coalition and the Regional Opiate Task Force, who then will talk to their legislatures and so forth. Do we go forth and talk to pharmacists in general? Only when we're talking about an ancillary crime. So if we get a forgery case, we'll go talk to doctors or pharmacists at that time.
Is it something I think we're going to talk at the next insurance committee meeting, because I know there is programs there that the insurance companies actually monitor or have programs that help prevent the overprescribing of these drugs. Yeah, which is as big a problem as what you guys are dealing with.
Absolutely.
Right.
I know that the state has taken the lead on a lot of that, and they're working with different legislative acts to try to address how that could all be tracked, but I know since this heroin thing hit, they've increased their vigilance on that, so.
So, Kira, I know I asked, but how many canine officers or dogs, do we have now?
Okay, so we have one dog that's a strictly a drug dog. It's a, what is it, a golden?
A lab.
It's a lab.
Yeah.
And then we have two shepherds that do general police work, and they're cross-trained in narcotics, so they can do both. So you have three dogs total.
That's out of our budget, correct? That's no longer funded. At one point, it was granted right through grants many years ago.
I don't think so.
No. Okay, no, thank you. And just two other questions. So just curious, I mean, I don't know if this is through the manager, on heart and hypertension, so we're on the hook, the town's on the hook for the drugs that are prescribed for the, as well? Is that what someone said earlier, that we have to cover the drugs as well? The prescribing of the drugs, is that correct?
I would have to defer to...
Yes, I occasionally clear requisitions that come through for officers that have been retired many years. So, it's not always a great expense, but we do have to cover that medication.
Okay.
And it comes through HR to me.
And I think what it is, Counselor, is when the heart and hypertension claim is filed and it's resolved at the labor department, there's an agreement the town enters into that they will cover for so many years.
Got it.
I'm sorry, yes, I was thinking something else, but yes, that is the case. We get a monthly report. We have a third-party administrator that processes those claims, and we get billed for those on a monthly.
Is that outside the insurance coverage we have, or is that included?
Outside of the insurance.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hey, just a general question, Chief. So I you mentioned for the dispatchers, we're down two as well. Am I correct?
We're down.
We're going to hire one very shortly. The manager allowed us to hire two of the four. So we'll be down two very shortly.
Dispatchers.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Dispatchers, sorry.
Yes, two.
So the overtime, so based on the budget, is the needed extra overtime, with the way the budget works out, even though you're down two, with the overtime, you're actually going to be paying more if we had the full...
If we had any period of time down two or three dispatchers, it'll...
So how long will that... So generally,
how long will that take?
Yeah, the train, right?
We actually have one in the process already because we had an existing opening. So that dispatcher is in background right now. She should be on board probably in a couple weeks. So that'll leave us with one opening. That dispatcher that's coming on will be in a field training program. So we still may incur some overtime while she trains.
Right.
But at least that's pretty far along.
We were just notified this week about another opening coming.
So the only reason there's vacancies is because of employment transition.
Right.
Whereas no, that is not a position that I am withholding approval for.
No, just curious. I mean, when we try, when we run out of new people, there is a cost to that. So I'm just curious what, if we have some sort of analysis that says every time we lose an employee, the actual cost it brings on, how the timing that it takes to bring on that employee, whether it be in the police department or anywhere else, the actual added cost it takes to continue to, to sort of, onboard, for lack of a better word, that employee. I bet it'd be an interesting... You keep that in account when you do your labor negotiations. I guess
sure.
I'm just curious to understand if we have that.
I am not aware that we have done those here, but that doesn't mean that we have not. That would be a question that I'd have to ask the human resources director.
Thank you, Chief. Appreciate it, guys. Thank you.
Questions? So I have one just, and it's whoever can answer it, but on the staffing, so we've got 101 on the employee page that we authorize within the budget, but the dollars, say for police officers, so it says 64 at 4.7 million. So if we were to actually fill to 64, do we have the funds for the 64? Or are we, so
no.
We're holding back dollars for those six positions last year.
Correct. That is correct.
Okay.
So you authorized 101, have previously appropriated for 96.
For 96.
That's
so that's
correct.
Five.
Or actually be 95.
Okay. All right. Any other questions for public safety, for dispatch, for emergency management? Very good. Gentlemen, thank you very much. Have a good evening.
Thank you, too.
Good night.
And happy Easter.
Thank you, thank you.
Yes. And good Friday, right?
And good Friday.
Who gets tomorrow off?
Apparently not the same.
I don't.
No.
I have to work tomorrow.
The banks don't get the account, it's not a government holiday.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I guess state doesn't get that holiday.
Yeah, it's not a government, it's not a bank holiday, it's off.
Yeah. I thought he was trying to pull more, bro, I already get that.
That's in that folder.
It wasn't everyone's folder?
That's mine.
That's yours?
You're right.
And good luck with all the shenanigans that went on today, and cleaning up after it, yeah.
Remember, I leave it, too. Remember Central Air put in Monday, Saturday, Monday, and Tuesday, so I was working from all places. I do like our new system a little better.
Oh.
I would please do that. The heightened security is making everybody crazy at work, you know? Yes, and our IT people had a real big eye open when they found out how much engineers actually know about just building computers.
Yeah, I was thinking about it all the way home, but I was getting worried.
We sometimes do more than they did.
You want to stay back.
They actually went close to the street. I remember Marty and Jenny, I went nuts on it.
Right there.
I don't think anyone was there last night.
No, but I remember.
We have all the things.
7-2.
Right, still fun with how many people.
I was telling him about 7-2.
All the winter work.
That you know not to say.
Got them all in there. Yeah, yeah.
Yep, had a lot of them, East Granby, too.
The roundabouts?
Yep, roundabouts.
Roundabouts.
Yes. Yes, I have to practice my roundabout skills in Colorado.
Speed control. They don't have the sign inside my ass.
No, they're not speed control, they're lane control.
Is there?
They have some speed.
Always get the shot.
Should be able to control every lane.
Thank you. Is it the same?
It's the same.
Presentation attendees, yeah, it's the same. So Joey has one?
Yes, I hear.
Make sure this presentation.
Breaking nothing, man.
Kevin, that seat's available right there, at the table.
There's three more important people down there. I don't want to take it away from the flagship stuff.
Oh, my God.
Actually, it says John's.
Oh, is that John's?
No, John, can you just go back to the beginning, accidentally forward it?
We could squeeze it.
The wheel, the little wheel on the top of your finger.
What are we on, right?
It's not moving.
Yeah, we're waiting for you.
Waiting for me?
Mm-hmm.
Well, other way, John. We'll go back.
What's this?
Up one more.
It's your cast.
I think we can go forward, but we can't go back.
So never go back.
Ready?
We're ready.
So, thank you for coming this evening, I'm Jonathan Bilmes, for those of you who don't know me, the Director of the Department of Public Works, and I want to introduce the team that's here and thank them for all their help with the budget. And you have a handout with the team, I'm just going to introduce them quickly. We do have some new council members who don't know our team, and so throughout the presentation, I'll be a little more, give a little more background information than I might otherwise for the benefit of the two new council members, but we'll again try and move it along. Our presentation is about, mine is 17 to 20 minutes, and then we have 2 5-minute interludes, so we'll all be done in half an hour, and then how long we go on is up to you. I just want to point out for Councilwoman Sakala, there are 7 people here, and there will be 2 other speakers.
Oh, Jonathan doesn't want a job.
Spend a lot of time at the
beach with some sand and some salt water.
It's about the right ratio, is it?
At 8?
Okay.
Getting low?
Billy Taylor, Deputy Director, you want to raise your hand, please?
Did you call your...
Mike Slazek, Assistant Director, Business Manager. Mark Gar, the Facilities Manager and Charge of Custodial and Buildings and Grounds. Danny Edwards, to his right, Assistant Director in Charge of Refuse and Resource Management in the Highway Divisions. Rick Davenport, Charge of the Fleet. And Rick, you're going to come up this way. Kevin Schlatz, behind me, the Water Pollution Control Superintendent. And we also have Ken Keto, our Custodial Crew Leader, from the first shift here. And I've excused the roads and the engineering team who typically come to this presentation because the format of the presentation it's not really set up to talk about those projects in any detail, so we gave them the night off. So without further ado, we will move on, if I can. Let's see.
That's
looks like it's on the right.
That's the second computer failure. If you hit 7.
I'm leaving. It's 7
minutes.
Just kidding.
We can have someone over there if we need to, or you think it's good, Brian?
I will give it another shot, see if we...
Okay, click. Well, I'll... Page down doesn't work, and there's a right click that worked. Okay, so this is the department overview, and we are the largest budget on the town side by far. We proposed, except for the Refuse and Resource Management Division, we proposed 0% increases, that is for the things that we control. Again, that doesn't include the health insurance, the workers' comp, and some of those other town-wide initiatives, but we went in on our operation side at 0, except for refuse and resource management, which we'll talk about for in a few minutes. And the budget analysis that is seen here is what you have in your budget books. The numbers will match, but does not include that $120,000 transfer we did about 5 or 6 weeks ago. We just felt it would overcomplicate the analysis in terms of this budget when it was adopted to that one. A few extra background pieces I added to the slide on the right is the percent of the department by division. You can see administration is the smallest, 3%, and the largest division by budget is buildings and grounds. And then personnel is to the right, and depending on the division, we have quite a variance in how much of the budgets are personnel. For example, water pollution control budget, only 31% is personnel, whereas in the custodial budget, it's 90, that is 89. And department-wide in the lower right-hand corner, 55% of our budget is personnel-related costs. Now this slide is, you will, a bonus slide, extra slide, because these projects don't really get reflected in the operating budget that you're going to see tonight. But they're, first of all, they're very important to the town, obviously. They also consume a lot of public works resources in supporting these. So these are the three referenda that the voters have authorized in the last few years, and the total amount authorized, the lengths of the projects, and how much we're anticipating spending next fiscal year. And again, public works is heavily involved, if not 100% managing all of those. So right there is $33 million on the books right now, just for those referenda, and that doesn't include a lot of other miscellaneous projects, which we can talk about later. And the other point I want to make is that the capital projects that we're managing and overseeing are almost double our operating budget. So again, tonight we're talking about a $20 million operating budget, okay? Be in mind, we've got $40 million of capital projects in addition to the $20 million stuff we do day to day. We're running $40 million of capital projects through public works. And that doesn't include a JFK project that we don't know what's going to be with that.
the top department budget cost drivers are supposed to stop at 5, but I had a tie at 6 and 7, so I put those two in there. We have some significant headwinds in the budget this year. The good news is we knew they were coming, and if you look at our budget presentation last year, we called out almost every one of these and said, these are coming, they're headwinds, we're gonna have to deal with them. Unfortunately, most of them came true. I mean, I wish there was some big good news in the budget, but these are things that are here. The biggest one, the biggest items, of course, have to do with the Refuse and Resource Management Division, which is why we couldn't get that to zero. But the big increases in the other divisions, we were able to offset, or we did offset, with cuts elsewhere. We come back to each of these as we go through the division budgets. Smallest budget is the administration division. I really don't have much to say about this. These are just the five things we needed to put in the slide. The only thing I want to point out is the part-time increase. That's because the environmental health and safety manager position was only was not funded for 12 months last year, and there was an assumption that that person would not be on board in July, and that was the case. And so this is basically just getting to a 12-month position. It's still part-time, but we needed to increase the money there. In the fleet division, again, these are all very small changes, very small numbers. The big issue in the fleet, which doesn't show up on this slide, is the personnel issue. That for most of this year, we've had two of the six mechanics not working as mechanics. They've been out, one on workers' comp, one on an external injury sick leave. So their salaries have been booked into the fleet division, but they haven't been working as mechanics. So there's been a whole bunch of things we've been doing this year. Our overtime is up. We had to hire part-time mechanics and so on. For the budget starting July 1st, we have assumed that those two mechanics are back full time. So the budget doesn't have a bump in overtime, and it doesn't have an increase in part-timers because, again, our assumption right now is that those two people that are out are coming back on or before July 1st, although we don't have an exact date yet. It's just uncertainty, and that's how we budgeted. You can say it was right or wrong, but that I'm just telling you what we have in there right now. In the highway division, a couple things I want to call out here. The first item, other professional services. The state of Connecticut has a significant new unfunded mandate that's taking effect July 1st relating to stormwater. We are submitting the application and the plan within a week or two. It'll be on Brian's desk. It's been in discussion for several years. When the first draft came out in 2014, the cost to Enfield we estimated would be $300,000 to $400,000 a year. Through a lot of negotiations with CCM and discussions and so on, that number's dropped quite a bit. Nonetheless, we've gone through all the requirements starting July 1st, and we've identified an additional $10,000 in other professional services, which you see here, to comply with that mandate. And also, there's money in the CIP for some one-time costs related to that mandate. The third item down is what's called maintenance and building. That is where the salt accounts are. That was one of our big drivers. We've tried, the price of treated, untreated salt has gone up, and we're just trying to reflect our true costs here. We did offset those increases with cuts, other cuts in that line item budget. That's why it's only a 4% increase, not the bigger number you saw elsewhere. And right below it are a couple items that we did reduce to try and, again, highway came in at zero. All in all, despite some significant price increases, they came in zero with the stuff that we can control. So we found and made cuts where we had to. Come on. Stuck. There we go. Refuse and Resource Management, the one division we were unable to come in at zero. The first item has to do with renting a truck for the leaf season. We used to rent two trucks. We tried to go down to one truck. Staff realized that that really wasn't efficient. So the increase in that rental equipment line is so we can rent a second truck for the leaf season to supplement our fleet. The disposal account, again, I do have a separate presentation. We can or cannot go into it if you like. There's significant increases in that disposal account due to refuse disposal and recycling, and a smaller increase for bulky waste. Let's see, and that's the main thing there. Like I said, I do have a separate presentation if the council wants to go into more detail on that during questions and so on. You have to advance it again, Brian. There we go. Water Pollution Control Authority. I borrowed this slide from Brian. There were a few technical corrections. The budget includes a repayment to the general fund of $300,000 a year. And that is money that the Water Pollution Control had, if you will, borrowed from the general fund and now is paying back $300,000 a year for 10 years. That is included in here. And the CIP amount in here of the $812,000, $550,000 is earmarked for pump stations. And I know there's going to be a CIP presentation later on, and you've heard from the town manager that he's proposing a different way of financing and funding the capital projects. But in the Water Pollution Control Authority, at this point, that is still a cash-funded amount. In other words, we haven't gone and done that analysis and looked at that even financing over a 5 and 10 year period. Presumably, if you want to pursue that with the general fund, then we can go back and look at the Water Pollution Control Fund and do something similar with the capital fund there. But that is a cash funding there. That's not meant to be a 5 or 10 year financing. There we go. Whoops, wrong way. Okay. And then in terms of the operating budget for water pollution control, a few things here. Again, the environmental health and safety person is shared 50-50 between the administration and the water pollution control division. So the bump up here is, again, for full year funding. The next line relates to the sludge disposal increase. Again, that's contractual increases. These are facilities that there's very limited numbers in the state, both for refuse disposal and sludge disposal. We're experiencing significant increase in sludge disposal costs. MDC in Hartford. And the goal is with the referendum and the plant upgrade that we will have some more flexibility to manage our sludge. Whether that ends up resulting in a lower cost down the road, we don't know, but at least we'll have more options. We can't say it's going to be a lower cost, but this is status quo. That project will not be done in the next fiscal year. So this is, as I said, status quo on sludge disposal. The next line is that we realized, and again, water pollution control came in at zero, but we realized that there really were not adequate funds for professional services in the water pollution control operation outside of the referendum. The referendum will not go on forever, and there are certain things that need to be looked at and analyzed and done that don't have anything to do with the referendum. So we've put some money in other professional services. Similarly, before the sewer fees went into effect a few years ago, there was no capital fund for water pollution control. So if they needed something, they were using operating budgets. So what we did is with the next two lines, the reason we zeroed those out is because now we have a capital projects fund in the water pollution control. So we zeroed out what I'll call those quasi-capital funds. Again, we use that money elsewhere to fund sludge and so on. And the last item, other supplies, those are the chemicals that are used to operate the plant and maintain environmental compliance. So we sharpened our pencils, we looked at bid prices of what's happening there, and we were able to come up with an 8% savings in our budget. So before we go on to the last two divisions, which are building and grounds and custodial, we're going to have one of our interludes here, and we're going to pass a handout out and explain how Nathan Hale, what our budget assumptions were about Nathan Hale, because it affects both buildings and grounds and custodial. So I thought we'd talk about this first before we look at budget changes. So that handout is coming around. And I'll turn it over for a few minutes to Bill Taylor to go over this with support as needed. So let's wait a minute. We do not have additional slides on this. This is just a handout at this point.
Thank you, sir.
Well, I have one, thank you. It seems we're here for a second year in a row talking about how the closing of a building will have an effect on the budget. And this year would be Nathan Hale, and we're assuming that that building will be closed as of July 1st, meaning there will be no use inside that building this coming fiscal year. So obviously we won't be maintaining it. We won't have custodial service. The only thing that we're anticipating doing is maintain the grounds. As a result of the closing, we're projecting a $62,000 savings in utility costs. That's based on historical usage of electricity and natural gas. And then our third bullet here is the budget contains no change in the current custodial staffing levels. And Hale, currently we have a head custodian who works in the daytime there, a full-time second shift custodian, and a part-time custodian who also works second shift. And I try to get into the reasons for, I guess it's counterintuitive that we need to have the same staffing levels next year with the closing of a building, but this gets into a discussion we had last year about the closing of Fermi. At that time, we assumed that that building would be very minimally used, that there would be some activities there, but basically it wouldn't be used very much. We're finding now that by September, over 80% of that building will be used for something. And there's a number of activities, things that have moved in there. So the assumption that we made last year about Fermi turned out to be wrong. I would note that when we proposed our budget last year, we had proposed 56 full-time custodians, and ultimately the budget only funded 55. So we lost one position last year. However, there's been an overall increase in the square footage that we're maintaining. Even with the closing of Hale in July, there's still an overall increase in the square footage that we were doing, that we were cleaning a year ago because of the heavy usage of Fermi. So the three positions that are currently at Hale, we're proposing that one of the full-time positions will be taking a vacant position in another school. There are, you know, we always have some vacancies in both full and part-time positions. The second, the part-time person would just be reassigned to another building where we need additional cleaning. And the second full-time position, we're requesting to convert to a second shift crew leader. As it is now, you know, we have 55 full-time custodians, and the number of part-timers vary, but it's around 8 or 9 normally. So we have close to 65 people on a custodial staff, and we have one crew leader who works first shift. So we've recognized for some time that we need a crew leader position in the second shift, but because of budget constraints, we haven't requested it before now. And we're hoping that this change will provide an opportunity to provide a second shift crew leader. The majority of our staff work second shift. The average number of phone calls that come in each month during second shift that have to be dealt are 27 inbound and 20, and that results in 84 total phone calls made every month to deal with issues that arise, absenteeism, other things that arise, injuries. Some people occasionally have an injury on second shift. And so the second shift crew leader would allow us to have a little bit of supervision during that time. It would remove the reduce the need for overtime for our existing staff. And in addition, we think the second shift crew leader will also fill in, that it won't be necessary for this person to be an administrator or supervisor full-time, that at least half of their time can be used to clean and fill in for absences. We have a couple pages of handout that go into further detail, and we'll pass those out and give you a chance to look at them. But that's the gist of what we see in terms of the closing of Hale.
Two things I want to add while the handouts are going around. Number one is that by basically bumping up or increasing that one custodial position to a crew leader, there is some additional cost. But that cost this year is more than offset by the fact that we had 5 senior custodians retire that were replaced by people at the bottom of the scale. So when we get to the custodial services slide in a minute, our total full-time salaries, even by getting that second shift crew leader, drops by $10,000. So we've increased our supervision and all the other things Billy talked about without increasing our full-time salary budget, number one. And number two, and this is where I'm going to have to defer to others to explain further, but we've identified savings in excess of the increment. In other words, that by bumping up that person, there's an increased cost, but we've identified more dollars than that in savings through some reduced overtime, and I forget what the other item was, but I don't know if that's on one of the handouts you got right now or not, but that we do have that on a handout if we want to get into that in more detail. So those are there's an operations reason, and this year we can do it without a financial impact to the custodial services budget. So we can either pause and discuss this or move on and come back to it at questions.
Yeah, I just have something quicker on this subject. And I know when the VOE was considering closing Nathan Hale, for some of us that may have been on the VOE and not here at all, we did discuss that, and I think some of us made the statement on the council, that the positions, because they're so short staffed there, that some of us expected that to happen, that those positions would have to come and stay here. I don't think it's a big surprise tonight to hear that. you know, and we realize your, the difficulties that are in the other buildings, and I really get the crew leader thing too, especially for all those 52 employees. So yeah, I, no surprise to me.
Okay. Joey?
What is the savings, even though we really don't have a savings, of the custodial staff coming out of that school?
Reallocation.
Yes.
Yeah, that number, it's the two full-time and one part-times, what is that, dollars, you mean?
Yes.
Yes.
We can, if we don't have that at our fingertips, we can get it for you.
Could you, and I guess my question is I'd like to see a running tally of the money we saved on the buses, the money we saved, you know, from the custodial, as we're going through finding what the savings really were, I'd like to see a running tally of all that, so at the end, we really know how much money we saved by, or reallocated.
Right, even if we should choose to reallocate it.
Right.
It still is monies that is used elsewhere to help with our running of our facilities.
Right, one might argue that without the closing of Hale, you might need 58 instead of 55.
Right, exactly.
Right.
We didn't look at that, that's.
Yeah, I just like to know, because, you know, that we just so we can have some accurate numbers for people when they ask, what was the real savings of that school? Because there are a lot of different things that people didn't realize that will come down the pike from it, that now's the perfect time to figure it out. I'm all set.
But you're asking what's under the control of the town?
Correct, right, right.
Under our control.
Right, town stuff.
Right. Mike?
I'm just curious, any overtime? Not that it would be a one-for-one, but why don't we come down $31,000 now that you're keeping those positions, assuming you're gonna reassign them to Fermi? If that's your justification for the crew leader, and so I'm assuming the activities that are ongoing at Fermi are already covered? And is that on overtime?
A lot of it is, yeah.
So can we get a breakdown of that? I mean, it seems like we'd save more in overtime if you're actually gonna keep those folks.
Yeah, well, I have some numbers.
Especially since Enfield High has so many custodians, you know. Yeah, again, I would sense the overtime would be lower than $230,000. And how are we managing that, I guess? If you're bringing full-time people into Fermi, that overtime should come down more than $30,000, in my opinion.
Well, we have a, we do have a graph. We have a graph, an overtime, custodial, part-time, overtime.
Yeah.
You have that?
I have that, yes.
That is a multiple year question that I've had, that I presented to now the third town manager about the management of the staff and what the proper mix is of part-time and overtime. So we're, I mean, there's not much more we can say about it other than we are, you know, we're working our hardest to manage these resources, but we're not seeing the big change in part-time, overtime total costs that one might have thought a number of years ago. And so we've recommended that we need to bring someone from the outside in to help us with our resource management on the custodial staff. The people we have do a great job, and they spend a lot of time, and the town spends a lot of time hiring part-time people, and we spend a lot of time managing them and tracking and all that. But if you look at this, graph, the total cost of part-time overtime is, you know, it's not going down. Now, would it be $50,000 more if we weren't managing it? I mean, that's what we need someone to help us look at. Because long term, it's a big issue. It's a lot of money. It's $360,000 a year, so it's worth looking at.
And I guess that's what I'm curious. When you say you're managing it, what are we actually managing? So meaning, what is the management controls that are within place? And B, what are the actual reasons for the overtime?
You have our experts. What are some of the reasons for overtime in the custodial?
Some of the reasons, most of the reasons are injuries, long-term injuries. We have
There's
a lot of programs. We're up to close to $19,000 just with Fermi this year that we expected not to have because it was supposed to be closed. We're over $19,000.
In addition, regular use of accrued time at 55 full-time employees.
But I guess I'm just curious, what is the protocol, the workflow when you accrue overtime? So there must be some sort of management process in place.
Yeah, we have assigned custodians at each location. We have two people at night at Nathan Hill. Whatever. If one calls in, we have to replace that that person on overtime. The building still has to be cleaned, and we have a lot of employees with a lot of seniority that have that amount of time to take.
Right.
We have custodians that help us out by taking time off. This last week, they say, "Look, there's nobody in the school, so I'm using some of my days." They're good like that also, but we have to have the schools and the buildings clean.
I'm just questioning the actual protocols and the workflow that so when you accrue overtime, how often is that happening, the reasons why it's happening, a little more detail on why. I guess I'm not questioning the building being open, I'm questioning how we're managing it. And kind of, you know, do you have it in writing, kind of the process, I guess? And how often is it, how often are people calling in sick? How often are you having to do these sort of things? I mean, these are things I'm looking for.
So you want to know, as a percentage of overtime, how much of it is because somebody was in sick? How much of it is
right.
because somebody's
Correct.
On vacation? How much of it is
Correct.
No call, no show?
Right, I'm not questioning the need for the building to be open. I'm questioning how we're managing it.
Okay.
Yeah.
And on top of that, piggyback to that, how much is it because we have to keep the fields up on Saturday or how we...
That'd be building.
Oh, okay.
But to your point, it still does recreation. We still have
right.
a lot of that money for basketball on the weekends. Like I said, Buzz Robotics, school programs, between dances, recitals, and some of that's a few of them. Say, like if a dance studio comes in and uses them on a Sunday, we can charge for that.
Right.
But there's a lot of recreation and school activities on the weekends that money comes out of, and we can get that.
All set.
Oh, and just Jonathan, thank you for this, by the way. Much appreciated. The name, putting the names. Very helpful. Thank you.
Donna?
I guess my question is kind of it comes from facilities that, you know, we're on the facilities committee. We're spending a lot of time trying to figure out when roofs were done, what kind of roofs are on. Who owns, I guess, the buildings? As far as knows, you know, everything that's in the building operational wise, you know, the schedule maintenance, how that's kept, is there a log, you know, I'm looking, you know, I know how many roofs now from looking at all the drawings need to be done. How do we keep that at the DPW so that, you know, we have some sort of plan? You know, JFK is the perfect example. Last time it was 5 years to change out the roof. Who keeps track of that stuff? And how do we keep track of that stuff?
Well, I would just say that I don't have an answer for you, but I know.
Do you feel my pain?
I don't know. And that is why we have been recommending a management study, because there are many things like that, assets that we're just can't seem to get our handle on. Is it because we don't have the right tools, or we need certain people or different skill sets? And so that's why we need to do that. And the town took over the maintenance of the schools, I guess, about 7 years ago.
Oh, longer than that.
More than
nine.
That. And so as far as I know, as far as I know, I haven't been here that long, as far as I know, no one really looked at that in a comprehensive way and say, what does that mean?
Yeah, because we take care of everything on a daily basis.
Double your staff, you know, take on 56 custodians and double the number of buildings, and what do you need to really manage that appropriately? As far as I know, that hasn't been done. I've been here 5 years. If it was done, no one gets showed it to me. And the staff that's been here a little longer doesn't have that too. So we desperately need those types of management tools.
You know, right, because Enfield High is coming on board, and I'm sure we have people that have been trained, I'm positive, right, down there at Enfield High? Well, at the last meeting, we were shown what you're going to receive, and what you will receive is a building integrated system that it's Bluebeam driven, which is like a PDF, but when you go over any of the parts of the building, the maintenance records can come up, the owner's manuals come up, all these things come up. This is the first building in the state of Connecticut to have this system. This system has to be embraced and used, because this is something that we're state of the art with this. And my fear is that we're going to get that and it's going to get put in the closet somewhere.
Can you add to it?
They're going to be at the 17th meeting, correct?
The facilities?
No, the
Randy?
Randy's
yes.
coming.
I'm sorry, yeah.
Well, when Randy comes, he's bringing Amara with him, and I believe the Board of Ed has seen this, and this is something that we're heading towards. I'm sure once we finish the water pollution control, we will have a similar type, you know, capability, that this comes to you as part of what was purchased. So I don't want to see it disappear. And I don't know, I mean, we need a records management system for the DPW. I mean, those drawings need to be someplace other than, you know, kept in drawers. And, you know, and I don't know how we fix that. I know, Brian, it costs money. It's all he ever tells me is it costs money.
Everything costs money.
Everything costs money.
Prioritize.
But
are you set?
Yes, I am. But make sure you see that presentation. You will be awed by it.
Easier question, perhaps, but in the schools, do we maintain? I'm looking at Billy and Kenny. Do we maintain a log of inbound requests from staff and teachers and principals? Is that documented, what kind of work requests that are obtained for each school, and is that?
Do you mean just like daily, like teacher needs paper, pencil, or reporters?
Custodial-wise or maintenance-wise, I mean, we have a good system that documents the types of requests that come from each school, and
yes,
you know, anecdotally and from just walking around some of these buildings, I mean, we know that you staff buildings at a certain level expecting, you know, the basic elementary school, and all of a sudden you have, you know, multiple carpets in each room, you've got air conditioners you're taking care of, you've got all kinds of things that didn't come with the building. And I'm just curious how much effort is spent, you know, analyzing what the as-built or, you know, as-assumed school looks like versus what it is now, and how that's making an impact on what it takes to maintain these buildings. And at some point, you know, we have a model of staffing. Does that need to change given the state of how people are teaching and what we're finding in these buildings? I don't know if that's something that's done often or looking at the types of requests you're getting or.
I think that's part of what Jonathan was asking about in the study. We have different, we find out constantly that we have different state programs that we have to work around. When the POE comes to us and says, this is the program, this is what we're mandated to do. We, like air conditioners, all of a sudden this room needs to be air conditioned. It changes all the time. Mm-hmm. As far as the daily work orders, they usually go to the principal and they send them to Village Grounds or Custodial Services, and they go to the head custodian and it's taken care of as soon as they get.
Okay. And I mean, I know you guys had a kind of a response rate metric that you'd shown us a couple of years ago. I mean, are you
satisfied, or is the Board of Ed satisfied with service levels for the most part?
We've done, Kenny sends out a yearly or every 6 months a survey to the principals, and we've got some really, really good, we haven't had a bad one, we've got real, real good ones.
Correct.
And they know, they all have my cell phone number, Kenny's cell phone number, Doug's cell phone number. You know, we're available all the time.
Thank you. Tom?
So back on the overtime, and this has been a six-year, I think I ask every year about that, you know, trying to get a grip on this overtime. And I do understand one thing. I do understand every basketball game, every school-sponsored event, every sports-sponsored event is overtime. And we're going to have that custodian staying after normal eight to keep the building open, the building closed in most cases.
Well, I mean, a lot of the activities that occur at night, the custodians are already there. They're cleaning. Those activities don't necessarily require more overtime.
So you do have.
But the weekends certainly do.
The weekends.
Yeah. I mean, most of our custodians work second shift.
Right, and then so every weekend do wrestling, and you know, they're all the high schools use at time. So my point is, to get this study, I've yet to see a request for it. Have you requested to have this study done? Because I'm like, yeah, I do. You got my hand up on it, and you've probably got another hand up at the end of the table. Because you're going to give us a breakdown of the overtime, which is great. I'd love to see that. I've never asked for that. I probably should have, because it's interesting to see which is going to activities, which is going, you know. And I think the activities is going to be huge. And I think sometimes it's a cost of business. And I don't think there's a whole heck of a lot we're going to do about it. But you know, at least if we had somebody to say that this may be a way to cut it down 5 or 10% over the next several years by either contract negotiating shifts or whatever the case may be, we need to do that because you know it's a big hunk of money every year in your budget that you could probably use towards other things if we let you. So I don't know. How do we get a study like that done, Jonathan? I mean, who does that?
There are people who do it, and I believe Ryan has proposed that in his CIP, and it's been, if you go back and look at the last few budgets, it'll be the last item that was not funded in the CIP. In other words, it's been on the list. I can show you the slide, and, you know, all the documents. We've been requesting it.
Request
it just hasn't
made
it. Yes, it has not made it, because this chart that I just passed around tells me, you know, we need to look at it. It's too much money, and we're not.
Maybe.
So, but we don't have the internal capability to do more than what we're doing right now. So we need some help, and that's what I propose. It just hasn't made it.
Maybe it doesn't. Maybe being on CIP is a dangerous spot for anything to be on. Put it quite frankly, if it was a line item on your budget, then we're here seeing it. And we've got it on the big board when we go through it. And that's probably why we're missing it, is because it's sitting in that CIP fund, which we don't all have total control of.
Was it included in the manager's budget last year?
No, it was the last item cut.
So for our deliberations,
we'd like to get that up on the screen.
So get a number together as to what would that cost?
It's
in your proposed CIP.
That is correct. Money for the study that Jonathan has requested and one that I've requested.
Okay.
So
great.
So
it's
when we get there, we'll make sure.
Right. And actually we'll talk about it tonight. My question for you folks is on this present this need for second shift crew leader. It's not in the proposed budget, correct?
No, it is.
Yes,
the funds are.
The funds, but not the position counts.
Yes, they are, because we did not reduce the staff at all, and they're not proposing to add any additional staff. They're talking about moving one of those staff from a full-time custodian to a crew leader. So it's a shift from a custodian to a
right,
to a full-time.
But if it should be, and this is where it should be proposed on this page, so that when we adopt the budget, it's adopted. Well, your numbers don't change at all. So if you go from current
Right, because it's, it's in the money, that's, it's in there, we have.
You got crew leader tier one, one current, one department, one proposed.
Yeah, we had in here crew leader, where did I find it here?
Regular custodial utility person tier one.
Oh, I'm sorry, I'm looking at the wrong, my apologies.
Hey, John Scott, 41, under public works custodial maintenance, right?
Right here.
Because this is, it's the first, anytime there's a new proposal, it's the first page I go to, and if it's not there, it's not in the proposed budget, and even if the dollars are there, we have to do something to make the approval happen at budget time.
I believe, I.
Custodian in charge, second, oh, second school tier one.
Yeah, you know what,
But it's still, the position count is still 333.
I do understand, and we printed these, before I could correct the final thing, so I do apologize, we didn't get the corrected version out to you. Give me 1 minute here. In the one that is on the town website, and I will get the corrected page to you.
So if we can get, we can do a substitute page, you know, if the dollars don't change or whatever, so.
The budget book that is being printed, it has been fixed on that, and I apologize for not getting the corrected page to you.
Okay. So, when I didn't see it here, I was gonna like, all right, for our deliberations, please put all the numbers together so we can throw it on the board, but if it's in the budget that we don't have, please get us the page.
Well, it was in the numbers, it was a matter of getting the detail to.
Yeah, but when we adopt a budget, so it's like, when we adopt the budget, if we made no changes, the budget that was presented to us as a council on that first meeting is the budget. Doesn't matter if there's 10 other variations of it, we're operating off of this one. So just, but we can substitute in pages so we understand what we're adopting, so.
Jonathan, on page 41 in your book, I think this is it, sure. Top line.
Fixed job class, it's only $10,000.
But isn't that the difference?
Yeah, that's the difference.
That's the difference.
That is the increase.
Wait, and you don't have to get it for tonight, don't.
We do have it, we have.
Yeah.
It's in a little different form.
It's in a little different form, but it shows you the change from this change, but it's not that budget book form, we don't prepare that schedule.
Oh, I know you don't.
But we do have, and the good news is the dollars are correct. The schedule is not.
That was my only question. Do we want to move on from custodial?
Thank you.
Hopefully you'll ask easy finance questions until he gets back, but beyond that, feel free to.
Thank you.
Just sorry, one more question. Are we asking just general, or is this, we want CIP next, or?
Well, we haven't finished this operations budget presentation.
I
only have a few more slides.
All right, go ahead, sir, sorry.
Yes. We're not on CIP yet.
Okay.
So.
So if you're ready to move on, we'll go to the next few slides. Okay, so just following up that good discussion, the buildings and grounds budget, a couple things here. The overtime for buildings and grounds has been increased to reflect the reality and the historical reality of what it's been. So we've bumped that up. The building maintenance line was, we basically restored last year's proposed budget. It was cut, there was just a $22,000 cut, and we've tried to get back, and again, this ended up being 0% overall for these things. The electricity and natural gas numbers, the third one and the fifth one, balance out, so electricity went up, natural gas went down, it was a net zero there. So that's all I wanted to say about buildings and grounds. Again, it came in at zero. Custodial services, oh, I'm sorry.
The gas went down, everybody else's gas went up. Gas, 51 versus 60.
Oh, gasoline.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry, I was talking about natural gas.
Yeah.
Our gasoline went down.
Yeah, everybody else, they went up.
Okay, what we did is for each division, we looked at the last 12 months of usage, the actual usage, and then we used same rates throughout the whole department and did multiplications and came up with our new gas budgets. So it's based on...
So if you have more vehicles consuming gasoline, why is your cost down?
Well, again, some...
Lowers.
I mean, B&G uses gasoline for all kinds of things. Again, that's based on an actual 12 months, and there's a unit price change, too. I don't exactly, we can pull that up for you, what we use in our budgets.
Well, I was just curious, because everybody else's gasoline budget went up, and yours is going down.
Well, when you say everyone else, not in DPW.
Everybody that came before us already.
Okay, well, I don't know. I didn't look at those. I had enough to do with my own budgets. I didn't look at everyone else's.
You want to ask a question?
Yeah, just the electricity. Did we figure any savings in there at all for the energy, or we should come in at the end just to refund what we got?
So you're talking about the Honeywell project?
Yes.
Okay. So the Honeywell project from start to finish is about 15 months. So we can't anticipate recording savings in accordance with the performance contract until the system is commissioned and turned over to us as fully operational.
Yep.
So we'll see savings over the next years as these units come online, but the guaranteed savings measures.
And any savings will just go back in the fund.
That is correct. That is correct. So do I expect these numbers to be less in actuality? I do. How much? I do not. So.
Just on your point with the gasoline, who control? You guys control the gasoline, right? Because basically everybody comes in and they're fobbing their departments and it gets charged out through, you know, one big master system, I would imagine.
Correct.
Who actually keeps that? Who checks it, looks at it, bills out,
right.
So that goes to the vehicle?
Correct, everything, it's all digitized.
Right.
It's automatically downloaded, and I build our departments individually.
So you can get exact numbers of what they used last year, each department,
right,
without a problem.
And I did provide that information to the departments.
And that's what we did. Now, for example, if there's a lot more snow removal in a given year, for example, highways, gasoline numbers will go up. They'll burn more gallons. They're on the road more, for example. But we took a 12-month actual, multiplied it by, you know, the gasoline prices, which are bid and set mostly by finance.
And what are the controls for folks to use the town gas? So the pumps at the station on Moody Road, for example, do we still have pumps down at Prospect Street in that building? So
no.
Still,
no,
that's
no.
Gone.
There's three sites, Enfield Police Department, WPC, and Moody Road. That's it. There's only three.
So what's the controls we have over that?
Rick, can you come on? They're having trouble hearing you, so just come speak closer to the mic for the audience.
So there's multiple things, ways it can be done. It can be done when you approach the site. If some vehicles are automatic, if there's a system in it, it automatically senses the vehicle's there, and all you have to do is just put the nozzle in and begin pumping, and all that information from the vehicle is downloaded, the gallons.
So we're monitoring that. So
yeah.
for example, some person, for example, is going in every single day or twice a day for a refill. We're questioning that.
I'm not filling my car here.
No, I didn't think you were, but I'm just saying that's what the control of that.
Yeah. Right. I'm not looking at who's filling what vehicles, but they can only fill Town of Enfield vehicles the way the controls are.
Okay.
They have to enter their ID if it doesn't have that automated
perfect
system. So there's really no way you can take fuel out of it unless you have permission to pump fuel.
Yeah, the ID as well.
Yeah.
Appreciate it. Yep. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yep.
So yes, so we did not include the Honeywell project in our budget. I'm sorry, I omitted to say that early on. It has impacts on overtime in addition to energy. I mean, we do have people working overtime supporting the Honeywell project, which is going to continue on to the next fiscal year. We don't exactly know how much overtime we're incurring, but they need someone to accompany them to buildings after hours, and Billy or Mark can talk about if you want any more of that. But we didn't include any of those impacts in the budget. They're just, you know, uncertain to us. Let's see, the last division that I had was custodial services, and we've already talked about this a fair bit. I just want to point out the last row showing, that's the full-time salaries line showing a 1% decrease. That's with the second shift crew leader position. It's a drop because of those other factors I talked about. So I won't go into that anymore. Let's see. Oh, no, we have one more handout. I'm sorry. This is something we talked about with the Public Works Subcommittee, and this is our second interlude. Just looking at a few revenues. On the recycling side, we are losing our $22.75 a ton for recycling. That's, you know, due to national, international recycling market trends. So that goes away. Bulky waste pickups, scheduled bulky waste pickups, we're recommending a $40 increase. And then we have two other fee changes that we're recommending that Mike Slazik is handing out now. And he and Danny Edwards can talk about these as much or as little as you'd like.
Handed it over to Mike, right?
I did. Do you want him to review this, or do you want to read it first? It's up to you. Whatever you want. Mike and or Danny Edwards can talk.
Take a quick review of it?
Yeah, if we could.
Okay, why don't you take it, make a summary of what is here, and then you guys can answer any questions.
All right. We were asked to look at the fees that we're charging for bulky waste because the cost to dispose of it has increased, and well, we don't want to make a lot of money on it. We want to at least recognize and recoup our costs. And if you look at the different categories that we have here for residential, you'll see commercial is a completely different category down at the bottom that we'd address separately. Now, currently we do remote pickup. So we'll send a truck out and we'll pretty much pick up anything that you put out with a scheduled pickup. And currently we're only charging $100 for that. And honestly, when you look at what we typically pick up, it's not covering our costs. So we actually did an analysis, and you look at this sheet. If you look at this sheet below, it will show you what our costs are for the average disposal, for the average load, the disposal, the time for the crew, the operating costs for the truck, and based on that, we were recommending that $140 for an average pickup would be more appropriate at this time. The second category is bulky waste at the transfer station when citizens bring it in directly. Currently, we're charging $7 a pound for up to 260 pounds. Well,
$7
for up to flat fee for up to 260 pounds. When it gets up to that 260 pounds, that's not close to even covering the cost of the disposal. Never mind anything else that's involved, running the scales, having people there, anything at all. And also, it causes some conflict because people get a little more than that because at the 261st pound. It reverts back to the flat rate of 7 cents a pound, and suddenly at 260 pounds, it goes from $7 to $18 and something cents.
So sometimes that generates some discussion at the scales. So hostility at the scales. We propose that we've looked at the actual cost of disposal and we're suggesting that we just start at an 8 cent a pound rate from the first pound with a $2 minimum. And it's simple, it's easy to understand, and it pretty much tracks the way it's done for commercial waste, but at a lower cost. The final thing we looked at was yard waste. Currently, we take yard waste for free, unlimited, with a $5 sticker. And frankly, we're told that there's some abuse, and there are some people that take their sticker and they come in a few times and bring a few loads. A typical load is about 400 pounds, based on the number of loads and the number of trips. It's a little under 400 pounds. I'm sorry, 338 pounds. Some people are there constantly, and there is the suspicion that residential stickers are being used for commercial purposes. So we have suggested that we limit the free loads to five a season, and then charge 4 cents a pound, half of the bulky waste fee thereafter for additional loads for yard waste. Sure. And finally, commercial waste, we would maintain the current 12 cent a pound.
So on the 4 cents, so did anybody do any calculations on to see what the average amount of loads that the average citizen uses to get that number of five? Because I get the abuse part. At first glance, I would say, you know, we're trying to stop our refuge workers for having to haul this stuff, and anytime a resident can take it for us, we're doing them us a big favor. So I don't want people to get that feeling that, hell, I'll just let them pick it up at the curb. So do we have a map on that by chance?
The
average load is 338.
We have the average loads. We've got the total number of loads. I don't know, Danny, do you have a total number of stickers? Do we know how many loads average per sticker?
No, I don't know.
We were told by the, Danny and I met with the people at the transfer station, and he told us that the number of people that exceed five loads a year is relatively small. It's a small minority of the people that have the stickers.
So that's my only concern. Yeah. So you hope we're able to weigh that. And last all is, and what really bothers me about our waste, the way we do our waste is commercial waste. I don't understand why we even take commercial waste. And the reason why we would plug our system up and at 12 cents a pound, which I'm not sure where that stands on what they would pay at any commercial dump site, but I don't know anyone that does commercial waste as a municipality. I don't see where the benefit is. I have a contractor tear my kitchen out, charge me for demolition, which would probably include dump, and then run down to the dump and get a $12 fee for it, which they would probably never get through all waste or anything else. So I just never did understand why we did. This is... And I'm sure you will. On the business side, I'm going to hear it right now. But I feel that it's just a way on the taxpayers to have to allow all this amount of commercial waste to come to our facility when we're not a commercial facility.
Well, the advantage to taking it at 12 cents a pound is that is significantly higher than our disposal cost. So if we take that in, it does subsidize the residential taxpayer that brings it in, because we're trying to price this to cover our disposal costs, but we still have to maintain the scales. We have employees there. The scales have to be certified every year. They get new software. They get maintenance. Periodically, we have to do repairs at the station. In fact, on the CIP, There's some proposals to put in, I don't know if it was pushed out, but a water line in, because there's no water there. So there is a cost, but...
Are we making that much money on this? I'd love to...
No, we're not making that much money, but it is a...
I really would, on what we're actually making for it, on it, and what we're actually doing to dispose of it. I don't think 12's enough. I would see it around the 20 cents a pound. I mean, if you're gonna take commercial waste, then, but go ahead. I need more information.
Okay, when we did this, well, probably back about 8 years ago, the idea was, is if you look, there's a different rate for them to get a dump permit. So they're paying an increased fee there. And we had a profit margin put in there, so we had some profit put away. And really, it's not for the contractor, it's gutting your kitchen, because he's gonna go to USA, because it's a lot cheaper. It's for that guy that comes in, has just some little stuff, and gets rid of it. But we are making money on this, and it was just a convenience. So that was one of the reasons why we did it. But to my next point, I just want everyone to know, this yard waste was not approved by the DPW committee. We actually strongly were against it. I don't feel that we should be charging at all for yard waste. And, you know, we took the people's leaf vacuuming away. We make things tougher. Why are we gonna, you know, pigs get fat, hogs get slaughtered. Why are we gonna make it so the people on the street is gonna be so much easier, even though it's more expensive for us to put it in their tipper barrel, when we're still gonna pick it up. So to charge them for yard waste is crazy, because we're only gonna pick up 10 more tipper barrels at the side of the street. When that person will bring it back to the dump, get rid of it, and they're done. And, you know, the thing on these contractors coming in, when we got rid of the vacuuming, we made it so they could come and they can get rid of residents' leaves. They had to have paperwork with them that it came. Now, I have no problem saying, if you come in with a commercial truck, you're still gonna be limited to the amount of times you come in. After that, these people can pay for another permit to get in. You know, so if you're a landscaper, and they see you're coming in more than a certain amount of time in the fall, then we charge you for another permit. But, you know, the leaves and yard waste, there ain't no way I could support any kind of fees on that.
As far as residents are concerned, we talked about that. The commercial people are abusing it. They go to East Long Meadow, they do somebody's yard, they come to Enfield, they fill their truck with somebody from Enfield, they got a piece of paper, and they're coming to our...
Right, so they would...
They're coming to our facility, and they're doing by load, so they're abusing it, and I think we've discussed that to do a separate situation with them.
Shouldn't even take commercial leaf then, they should dispose of it down in Ellington, right at the site where they grind it.
Right, and they get away with getting rid of it for free there.
No more problem. And we gotta look at this commercial waste rate, I think it's too low.
Mike?
Sorry, Joey, or do you mind, so the transfer station, you're still a permit that the resident has to buy in lieu of a $20 roughly?
Right.
Right, so what's the permit card?
And then there should be so many times you can go.
Wait, how much is the permit now? Anyone know? $5?
$5.
$5, and how many visits you get on that?
Unlimited, right?
Unlimited?
Just pay by the pound.
So you pay it by the pound. So here's, it's funny, this brings back a conversation I had 15 years ago. It's funny, everything comes full circle. The thing that always gets me about fees, and especially like the bulky waste pickup, for example, I'm doing the math, and I apologize, I always do the math. Out of the 365 you had scheduled pickups, 89 were for one, again, I'm not blaming anyone, you guys are doing your job, you gotta go pick up the blight ordinance, right? So someone's home has left all that junk in the front yard, and you guys gotta go pick it up. And it's funny, it's, so basically 25% of your visits are based on folks who unfortunately didn't take care of their homes, or for whatever reason had to abandon their homes, or it's a blight issue, if I'm reading what you're saying on the top. So then you're basically jacking up the fee 40%, you know, I'm not saying you're covering that cost, but you're trying to cover that cost, and it penalizes the people who are taking care of their homes, which is always the problem with me with fees, is that we want people to take care of their homes, we want people to maintain their properties, and then but they have to dispose that stuff, and then we're charging them more to do what we want them to do.
to do what we want them to do. So I'm just saying, I get it, but it's still for me a tough one where we're asking people to maintain your home. And so, and again, $40 is a lot of money for some people. I'm just saying, and or even $20 now when you go to for your permit is a lot of money for some people. And I'd hate the fees deter people from maintaining their property.
In the expenses where they calculated what the cost they were trying to cover, he's only covering the labor for the schedule.
Right, I'm just doing
Right. So when you bring that's the cost they're trying to cover for the scheduled piece. Okay, it's not expanding it. And then we used the same estimate of the cost on the unscheduled, but then added in time for the blight officers. And that's where we came up with an additional cost per...
But in theory, that person's still paying for someone who didn't maintain their property.
Well, so...
Because you're increasing your fee, correct?
Well, but this becomes a philosophical question of ad valorem. So we can clearly demonstrate that even for those people that are using the service correctly, they're still not being billed the total cost of the service. So since the vast majority of taxpayers don't use the service, they're underwriting the expense for the few people who do.
Right.
So this isn't an attempt for us to
profit
from.
I'm not saying it is.
What we're trying to do is we are trying to recoup our cost. The reason that you're not seeing the cost on the unscheduled at this point in time is because there's a technical legislative glitch that prohibits us from seeking reimbursement for the unscheduled pickups. Now, I have submitted legislation to the town attorney's office for review that will fix that, and we have put together a fee schedule that includes not only RRM, but also includes that code enforcement officer, not for the initial visit to identify the violation, but for the follow-up visit to confirm that whether or not that issue has been rectified. If you've rectified the issue upon notice, there's no additional charge. If you didn't rectify the notice, then there is the additional charge that would go into this. So we're giving every resident who would use the service in accordance with the process and the procedure the benefit of the doubt to pay for only the service they're using. It's only for those that ignore the rules of the service that they have to pay, that they would have to pay more, and that is the labor and expense to send a code enforcement officer to confirm.
Right, okay, fair. And just my last question, the 4662 resident trip, that includes the trucks that go out to the residents to pick up the tipper barrels, or no? Yard waste transfer station, it says 466 residential trips. Does that include the truck that's going out and picking up the tipper barrels?
No, sir.
No.
That's just residents.
You stop, right?
People are just coming to you.
Got it. Okay, thank you.
All right, I got Bill and Donna.
To Brian, to what you were just saying, there's a glitch in the blight ordinance, or there's a glitch in the statute that allows you to bill for that unscheduled pickup?
Can't
bill.
So it says that the town shall levy a fine for violations. So because we are levying a fine, you have the right to appeal. So until you exercise your right to appeal, the trash has to sit there, the debris has to sit there. And not every time that we get the chance to evaluate these issues are we getting folks that are responsive. Are we supposed to be citing, and I have to review the language, but there's an obligation upon the tenant, and there's also an obligation upon the property owner. So am I serving the tenant? Am I serving who lived here but now is at an unknown address? Am I serving the person who owns the property in Texas, whatever the case might be? So we get into these huge delays in being able to recoup the cost. So effectively what we're doing is we are including a broader definition of what presents a nuisance within the right-of-way, and then we're also changing the language from shall to may, understanding that our primary focus is the ability to collect the abandoned refuse, and just in that mere aspect we can then lien the property for that expense. So we'll get our money in the end, but we forego that very bulky process, if you will, no pun intended, to have to fine and notice and due process for properties that would fall under.
At that point, when you're in doing it through the blight ordinance, you can actually calculate the actual cost, not necessarily the scheduled fee-based cost. Is that correct?
Right, correct. So that's why we would add in the additional factors for the code enforcement officers to go back out and make that secondary inspection.
Good. Well, look forward to that in the next couple of weeks through the development services review. I just want to say I appreciate you guys going through this effort because John, this is what we were just talking about last week. We were wondering if these types of proposals were coming forward. And while they appear very well reasoned, I the yard waste one, and we can discuss this at length some other time, but the impact of weather on what a resident would pay in this regard is way too dramatic, I would think. I mean, one rainstorm and what was a $10 drop-off is now a $30 drop-off. And ultimately, it's just going to result in more use at the curb, which I think is something. I think getting less leaf pickup at the curb ought to be what we are seeking here, and not less use of the free drop-off. I'd be curious what your analysis is on what could be done with the basic entry permit, annual permit, and how that, where that revenue might help you, because $5 is darn affordable, and I'm thinking for what the value in the leaf drop-off, $10 would be just as affordable. Particularly since you're changing the model on the just use of the transfer station, so I don't know if you know offhand how many permits are active on an annual basis.
No.
Okay.
Well, we have a record.
All right. That if you could get that to us before we deliberate, that would be helpful. I think that's all I have to say. And other than one more. And I know you guys were discussing this in your committee, at what point does our understanding of recycling begin to change if it's not benefiting the municipality in the ways that we thought it would? How far away are we before it becomes cost prohibitive to have this grand recycling model?
Well, first of all, there's a state law.
Okay.
So, like any other state law, you just can't unilaterally decide not to follow it without some consequences, whatever they may be. And even right now, if it costs $10 to pick up a ton of recycling, it's costing us $70 if that was in the trash barrel. Let alone the fact that it's against the state law, and you know the place that you're taking to would be violating the state law and may have to shut down if they were knowingly taking. Right now, you can't knowingly take recycling mixed with the garbage. So you just couldn't do this without a tremendous. I don't think it's cost effective right now, anyway, because there's still a cost avoidance of $60 a ton. A ton of newspaper in the recycling, ton of newspaper in the trash, you're saving $60 a ton. Still, the economics were better a few years ago, but it's still positive.
So there's no having that material in the waste stream that gets turned into electricity. I mean, it's not.
Again, the state.
But I know the state law was put into effect to help recapture materials that had a value on the back end. If they have no value, I mean, do you see that changing if there's so much glass on the market that it's not being purchased? Well, what value is there? Is it harmful in the waste stream, or was it strictly done to provide
the recycled material?
Well, there's also,
as a commodity.
There's also various energy benefits and greenhouse gas benefits and things like that that we certainly aren't prepared to roll out the numbers here today. So first you've got to understand you'd be violating state and federal laws, and then we'll go on to that and so on. I mean,
I was just curious because
it's
not, at Public Works, he did say that, and I think maybe that's what he's looking for. Cost efficiency, we're not, even though we're recycling, we have to, it's still costing us more to get rid of the recycle than it is to, you know, for the that recycled material, correct? You mentioned that.
Currently, we get $22.75. We get a revenue, we being the town,
correct,
for a ton of newspapers. That's because that contract was signed 5 years ago. And most of those contracts had that kind of a revenue. The world has changed. It's an international marketplace. China is the biggest driver. These are things we have no control over. The market is topsy-turvy. We are in the absolute worst time to be going out for a new recycling contract. But no one knew that 5 years ago. If you did, you would have signed a 10-year contract or a 7 or 8 year contract. No one knew what it was going to be. But you signed a 5 year contract, so the company has been taking a hit. All the companies that enter into contracts back then have been eating it, trying to renegotiate all along. They have honored our contract, but they and everyone else have made very clear those numbers are not going to be there right now. The markets turn around again, and it's all, again, based on world economies and things that we have no control over, the markets will be better. So that's why we're looking at a 3-year contract, and then in years 4 and 5, we're negotiating a possibility of revenue again in years 4 and 5, depending on the world marketplace. That's what we're in the process of negotiating. Those negotiations are not concluded. So that's where we are on the recycling side.
Still in our best interest to recycle, though. The more the better. Okay.
Good. Donna?
I guess mine pertains to yard waste pickup. I understand spring yard waste and I understand fall yard waste. But in the summer, everybody has very minimal yard waste. So the truck is driving all around town just to fill its buckets with yard waste. Could that personnel be better served during high vacation times to maybe mitigate your overtime a little bit during, say, mid-June to mid-September? You're going to put them back in your lawn where they belong.
She doesn't want to pick up grass. I don't know that.
Yes, you are.
You're going to bring them to the dump at 4 cents
a
pound.
That's right. There you go. But it just seems that, you know, it's a really great plan having the Friday. I think that's great. But I really think that we really need to think about the overtime is lots of red. And could that possibly balance
that's
a little bit of red out?
All set?
I'm all set.
All right, I got one more.
Go ahead.
This yard waste bothers me, guys. How many households do we pick up trash on?
I asked the assessor, there's about 13,600 units or something
really
about that amount.
We really have a big problem on yard waste, huh? We only picked up 4,000. It's not even, we picked up 4,000 loads that they brought in, and we have 13,000 households.
Right.
That's nothing. Even though these contractors are bringing stuff in for other people, this is so minute of an abuse problem that I don't even think we should be talking about that. Because at 13,000 houses, we only had 4,000 trips. So that, you know, that's not even...
That's for residents.
We pick up only for residents, more or less.
But this is the residents that brought it.
Exactly.
You're talking about...
Right, but if we have 13,000 houses in the town of Enfield that are making yard waste, and only 4,000 people have come in to
get rid of yard waste.
At the station.
At the station, I don't really see a big abuse problem.
Because you're assuming it's one resident per trip, not the same resident coming in.
I understand that, but there's still 13,000 houses.
If somebody's abusing the town system, they should have to pay for it.
If I am picking up stuff for other people, it's still coming off. I mean, we may, you may have one guy coming in six times a day to get rid of stuff, but he's still, for the most part, probably picking it up, at least five of them from the residents of town. So if they bring it in or someone else brings it in, I don't see a problem. We're well under one house, one trip a year per house.
So let me ask this question, just so I understand what you're saying. You're saying if we know somebody is willfully abusing the town system, to let them dump because they're doing well under the 1,300?
No, what I'm telling you is, if they have their forms where this stuff is coming from, and they have all their affidavits that they're getting rid of, I mean, you're never going to be 100%. You're going to have the guy that picks up the yard in East Windsor and brings it to Enfield. But for the most part, I would think that most people are picking it up from 74 Town Farm Road, 4 Simon Road, 155 South Road, and then they're bringing that to the dump to get rid of it, or the transfer station. So, I mean, granted, I'm sure that we have some coming out of Winkler Road in East Windsor, but you know, what you call abuse still could be coming from the residents of Enfield.
Right, but I think their point is really the only people that stand to have an increase in their fee are the people who are abusing it. So the general population who are not abusing it, which is, let's say, 80%, are not going to see an increase because they're taking less than five trips.
If you live in Southwood Acres, you're taking more than five trips.
Yeah,
to the dump.
I would be taking like 30 trips.
Right. And so that's where the problem is. You know what? There's going to be people abuse everything. No matter how well you patrol something, how well you take care of it, someone's going to abuse something. Most people don't. I guess, you know, you just got to make it harder for the people there that are coming in all the time to dump it. You know, make sure they have paperwork, make sure whatever. But again, you know, third and fall season in Southwood Acres, you know, one person.
Or 35 South.
Yeah, especially seeing, I live right across the street from the transfer station.
The
I see cars going in there all the time.
Didn't we give them an extra tipper barrel to do that?
When they come into the transfer station with yard waste and they show you something saying, I picked up from Scott Copeland's house at 9 Allen Street, do you keep that paperwork?
Yes, we have the certificates, those tickets that they bring in, we keep those.
So if they were going to Donna's and picking up 10 loads a day, there would be 10 tickets.
No.
Why not?
It would be one ticket.
Well, for every trip. Maybe there's your issue.
They used to do that with septic, I think.
Anytime they leave a property with a load, they need a new ticket. I mean, because I could see them just making duplicate after duplicate, and it's, or they picked up five today and they had five separate tickets, and they said, okay, I'm only going to use this, only came from number one, and I'm going to hold on to the other four that I'm going to use for the East Long Meadow house tomorrow. So maybe you need to revamp. It's kind of like it's pass. It's an easy pass getting in. Well, you got to take it. And it's per load that goes, they need a new one. And you strip them of their paperwork and you don't give it back to them.
And on the commercial side, I could see you getting to pay for the permit to get there. And even if you're, you know, if you're bringing a big load of leaves in a dump truck that you got, a tipping fee, not of weight, but per time to go there. So now it'd be much easier for them to go somewhere else to get rid of them, or they can get rid of them for nothing. But to just say we're going to charge 4 cents a pound because you're coming in with something, you know, we told these people we weren't going to pick up your
we weren't vacuuming at the street, and we were gonna take their leaves from their contractors. And so, you know, I could see maybe a per load charge, a reasonable per load charge for someone coming in with a dump truck or something like that, but to go at, like Scott said, if the, Bill, one of them said, well, you know, if they're wet leaves, that load's gonna get very expensive. And actually, that was one of the things when we got rid of the charge for yard waste, because we used to charge for yard waste, is that we had an elderly ex-police officer go to the dump to get rid of two bags of leaves, and it cost them $70.
Yeah.
And that's why that was one of the reasons why we did it.
Well, again, we were looking at... it's obviously that the rate that's included here is not one that's acceptable, so we will go back.
Revamp it.
We'll see if there's a process improvement.
The thing is, a load of acorns could be a ton.
We'll address the issue.
Eddie Johnson was the one.
Okay.
It cost them $70 to get rid of...
You did the bulky waste one. Do you want to go, or is that all of this?
That's all of this.
All the data.
Oh, okay.
Only one last slide this part.
So, to my other question, so are these changes in fees part of the budget, or are these new proposals? Like, have you built this into the revenue?
We actually have been coming in under budget as far as the revenue for the last several years, so I did not add any more to the revenue to cover those. For those fees.
So these,
no.
I guess,
these are the old fees.
In the vernacular, we would have to bring in a proposal to set the new fees as part of the budget process.
Correct.
Okay.
We charge for trailers as well, correct? Like when I go to register my car, I register my car and my trailer. There's an additional fee for a trailer?
I'm not sure. Not in the last few years.
Not in the last few years. There used to be, though. Okay. Thank you,
Bill. I think it was when we first did it.
I used to get a separate sticker for a trailer. I haven't gotten one in
Okay.
Okay. Go ahead, Jonathan. You said you're going to be done an hour ago.
I know.
Our part was that.
Yeah, you said it was up to us after that.
That's
yeah.
what I said.
Yes, we did you good there.
So just to summarize,
if they listen to
you, we have a budget that maintains services. We have a net reduction of 2 from last year's staffing proposal. That's 1 custodial position. Has been reduced. When we came in last year, 56, we're now at 55. And last year we recommended a staff person at Water Pollution Control as a project manager. That has been outsourced. So those 2 positions are not in this year's budget. We have no treatments for emerald ash borer in here. That's a topic that's getting a fair bit of publicity about that disease and what to do. And you know, it's just, again, to keep it 0, we couldn't do it.
So what is that?
That is an insect that attacks ash trees. And there's different, some communities are there's a quote-unquote a treatment. And then there's also, when the ash tree's dead, a removal. There's different ways to do it. The costs are about the same, but they're significant. We did have an ash inventory done about 3 years ago. But again, the budget hasn't allowed us to include those.
How many
ash trees do we have? Oh, my God. I don't know off the top of my head. Do you know the number? I don't remember the number.
I mean, is it a lot?
Well, first of all, qualify this answer.
Yeah.
He inventoried the rights of way along the road, so it includes street trees within our rights of way, and then our parks and, you know, the town green and that sort of place. He didn't go into
forests.
Oh, really? And it's the number slightly over 200.
I didn't think we had a lot of ash trees left.
So he inventoried them and noted their condition. The thing you need to know about this this insect is if they get into the trees and they haven't been treated, they kill 100% of the trees. And once they kill the tree, it falls very rapidly. So once these things get into the trees, if you haven't treated them, you need to remove them quickly. Otherwise, they just fall. And a couple, I think DEP did a couple case studies. One was a rural town, I don't remember what it was, one with the city of Hartford. And it was an average of $500 to $700 per tree for removal. And I'm trying to remember what the.
You have to grind them, right?
Yeah, you have to grind them so that you. Kill the bug.
So how close is this bug to Connecticut?
East, well, it's been in Connecticut for some years. It started off in the southwest part, Fairfield, New Haven counties. It's been found within the last year or two in East Windsor. So it's coming quickly.
On that note, we also did increase our budget for snowplow operations. And just at point, we are underfunded for environmental health and safety. This is the first year that we have an environmental health safety manager. There's a lot of things we need to be doing annually, and next year we need to come in with a budget for these things. We're trying to mix and match and find money in different accounts. Depending on what happens, we may have to cut one hazardous waste collection. Right now we do two a year. We may not have enough money for two. We may have to go to one. There's also no money in this budget for union contracts. We have 154 of 156 full-time employees are in unions, and all those contracts are being either negotiated now or will be negotiated, and this budget doesn't include that. We did not include EPC, Energy Performance Contract impacts. We talked about that earlier, and we don't want to miss out on the fact that the capital budget is important for Public Works, which is next. It's already 9:10, but that's the end of the presentation, and I think, I don't know if there's any more questions.
All right, any other questions for Public Works?
As an aside, can I get, and I forgot to ask, I need one copy extra of everything that you guys handed out, because I forgot to grab them for Liz.
Yes.
So if I can just grab one copy of everything? Thank you.
Go ahead.
Sorry, do you guys do, judge everything by work orders?
We don't do everything by work orders.
So we do some things by work orders, but routine, repetitive tasks are not. We don't issue a work order for the custodian to sweep the floor every day, for example.
Right, on a daily basis. Well, how does someone, if they're not involved in a project, how do they assign the work? A given project or a given piece of work, for example.
That's up to the division managers and their crew leaders to look at who's in that day and what the list of jobs are.
Yeah.
Now, while we're talking about the daily pickup of refuse and recycling, that has to be done. A lot of custodial tasks have to be done. There's not a lot of debate or discussion on some of those things.
Just tracking what work is being performed on a yearly basis or by seasonal basis, or I'm just curious.
Some things we do, and some things we don't have metrics for.
Like in the summer, how many fields are we taking care of for baseball?
We have all those numbers. In fact, they were normally part of the presentation in other years. We have 54 athletic fields, we have 400 acres of parks and grounds, we have 29 buildings, 1.5 million square feet, etc. All those kind of things we can get to you. We did not include this year as though that kind of background.
When you go year to year over budget, it's kind of nice to know what you're doing from one year and you compare it to the next. This is a general idea. I'm just saying it's a general idea.
But that assumes you're doing what you're doing in the manner that meets best practice.
No, it's not assuming that, but that's to get to that point, you kind of have to understand what you're doing to get to that point. That's what I'm saying. I don't know if we are applying best practices. I'm assuming we are, but it'd be nice to kind of quantify that.
So one question, and I think it's for highway. So now that winter, knock on wood, is over and done with, and we've got the winter damage that's out there, when do we start repairing broken curbs ripped up irrigation systems, mailboxes, stuff like that. Is that, do we have a set schedule of when we start?
We do all that in between here and there.
Okay.
We've been repairing mailboxes even during the winter, depending on how bad the mailboxes are. The yard waste, I mean, not the yard waste, the lawns, we were repairing. Then we got a couple of extra snowstorms that we were kind of hoping didn't come. So now we're repairing some more again. So we just do it within the weather, and we've already started them. We've been started.
So if a resident contacted the town on March 27th about a ripped-up irrigation system, and it's now April 13th, and no one's done anything, and they're getting to the point where you're going to start losing the time to seed the lawn because the irrigation system needs to be fixed, supposedly. So, like, when's the expectation of, if you spoke to the town on March 27th and nothing's happened and it's April 13th, when should it be repaired?
Since March 27th, we had two other snow events. So, unfortunately, we can't jump on all of them as soon as we get them, and we just get to them as soon as we can. We have a long list of yard issues.
Yeah.
Technically, I only remember one irrigation problem, and I just spoke to a lady. She actually works for the town. Other than that, I don't remember another irrigation email. Okay. I might have got it, but right off the top of my head, I can't remember another one.
All right. So what I'll do is, because I've asked them to take it off of Facebook and to email me, I will forward it to you.
That will help.
But it's on, I think it's on Indian Run. So.
Yeah, the only thing I know about Indian Run is we have a curb. So.
Okay. All right.
So the right of way.
That?
Why are the irrigation systems in the right of way?
Well, maybe it's in the right of way. I don't know. He might be at where people dump stuff. I don't know. But that's for these guys to figure out. But when he contacts the town and he doesn't get a response in 2 weeks, that's an issue.
Right.
So, okay. You had something.
Yeah, I do. No. Now you're blowing my whole train of thought. Okay, I know what it is. What was the impact on our staff? Because you had the referenda impact. How much impact did the Enfield High School consolidation have on staff, other than custodial? And
we had a very large in the last few years, owner's responsibilities. Everything from removing equipment, from when we took all the equipment out of the shops, a lot of electrical work we had to do. There was just
moving costs.
Yeah, it was I can find some figures, but it was
moving costs that are charged against the project.
Not
when they move.
Not everything. There was a lot of things, such as moving the shop equipment from Enfield High to Fermi, and then move back when it got in. They did get some new equipment. There was a huge cost of when they shut the cafeteria down. All those freezers had to be shut down when they removed all the freezers to put the new ones in. All that food had to be prepared at Fermi and brought over, and all that food needed to be, all the frozen food needed to be stored at Fermi. We had to rent three outside freezers. And that was
and under, those weren't covered by referendum?
No, that was the owner's responsibilities, and I don't want to give you an exact figure, but it was well over $10,000. So I mean, those are the types of
right.
I'll give you another quick example. And when we moved, they called it the auditorium and the cafeteria. When they were eating in the auditorium, when they closed the caf,
yep.
Our electrician had to drop all the power to run all the steam units. That was not part of the project. That was all owner's responsibilities that we had to pay for, and we had to, materials, time. There was just an awful, awful lot of.
Well, it was a $100 million project. I mean.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely, but and also there was quite an overtime cost, construction overtime.
Yeah.
these guys work 7 days a week, they worked on holidays, you know, so the project is beautiful, but there was some cost our way.
Because I know the energy performance contract is supposed to be very minimal impact to our staff. That was part of why we went to a performance contract, is that we would not be putting stuff out to bid or things like that.
We're doing all that, I expected this.
You're doing all that.
We're going out, we're procuring services, we're paying people overtime, we're having numerous meetings. Billy's the point person, he can go into some of those things that you're doing right now.
First of all, we meet every 2 weeks with Honeywell and just go over issues that arise, the schedule and so forth. Not to speak for John, but his deputy director is involved in procuring the money and overseeing that side of things. But for us, for example, the water conservation work is just about done now, but our plumber has gone with them each night into the buildings to help them find water shutoffs, free up shutoffs that...
That's a, something that, that's back to not knowing the buildings. We don't have mapping and...
But they don't either. They don't.
Right, I know. We need to be better.
And then there's like our administrative time to figure out how we're going to get gas service to this, as you're aware of, to the library.
Mm-hmm.
It's our responsibility to take care of all the hazardous materials that they encounter along the way. So I've had to, you know, we've had to contact companies to test for asbestos and other hazmat in all the boiler rooms. That's our expense as well. So that's part of the, you know, the owner contingency.
For the schools, there should be pretty good records as for the asbestos.
There is, but it still has to be tested.
Right. Well, that's back to my point that we don't have those things that
we
should
have. Well, we do
have,
I mean, because of federal law that requires certain things in regard to asbestos, there's pretty good records.
Yes, there are.
And we do a reinspection of all those schools every 6 months to make sure there hasn't been any deterioration in the asbestos-containing materials and that we might have to remove so it doesn't cause a hazard. But it still has to be verified.
So we do have some owner responsibilities in these projects.
That's quite a bit.
Okay, thank you.
All right, anything else for Public Works? And we're gonna push off CIP conversation to our next meeting.
Oh, I'm so disappointed.
Thank God.
So
I'm gonna stay up till midnight.
At the request of Councilor Denny. No, people are spent and there's new concepts on CIP that, so okay. So then Tuesday we have, actually Tuesday isn't even listed on this one. We have a meeting Tuesday though, right?
Tuesday.
The 18th.
Oh yeah, I'm sorry. Yep.
Wait, you're pushing CIP to then?
Mm-hmm. So recreation, town manager, town council, library. Do we already do library? No.
No.
Finance, probate.
Start with CIP.
So.
Yeah, we can start with CIP.
Yeah. Because what do we have next week? We have council meeting Monday, budget Tuesday and Thursday. Okay. All right.
Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn by Peter, seconded by Joey. All those in favor?
Aye.
Those opposed? We are adjourned.